The victory over cancer is special. It's something I would chant. It's awesome, baby. It's awesome, baby.
That's awesome, baby, with a capital A.
Dick, welcome again to the ESPN Network.
Oh! They put a blanket on top of him. They say he can't get the ball, baby. He lets it fly. Oh, I can't believe it.
Booyah, booyah, booyah.
Everybody's ready to go. He's ready to go. I'm ready to go. And you're ready to go.
I'm John Saunders, as usual, joined by V&V, Jim Valvano and Dick Vitale.
I'm undefeated for 13 years, John. The last loss I had was against you in the regionals, baby.
Someday I'm going to get a job like that.
I had the good pleasure of introducing Jim tonight. He gave his legendary speech. We were presenting the Arthur Ashe Award. Boy, I stood there and I was in awe. And that speech is going to go on and on and on. I don't care what year you talk about, it is relevant.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
That's the lowest I've ever seen Dick Vitale since the owner of the Detroit Pistons called him in and told him he should go into broadcasting. Right? I can't tell you what an honor it is to even be mentioned in the same breath with an Arthur Ashe. This is something I certainly will treasure forever. But as was said on the tape, I don't have one of those things going with the cue cards, so I'm going to speak longer than anybody else has spoken tonight. That's the way it goes. Time is very precious to me. I don't know how much I have left, and I have some things that I would like to say. Hopefully, at the end, I'll have something that will be important to other people too, but I can't help it. Now when I'm fighting cancer, everybody knows that, and people ask me all the time about how you go through your life and how's your day, and nothing has changed for me. As Dick said, I'm a very emotional, passionate man. I can't help it. That's being the son of Rocco and Angelina Valvano. That just comes with the territory, right? We hug, we kiss, we love. And when people say to me, how do you get through life or each day, is the same thing. To me, there are three things we all should do every day. If we do this every day of our life, you're going to have, what a wonderful, number one is laugh. You should laugh every day. Number two is think. You should spend some time in thought. And number three is you should have your emotions moved to tears. Could be happiness or joy. But think about it. If you laugh, you think, and you cry, that's a full day. That's a heck of a day. You do that 7 days a week, you're going to have something special. And so I can't help. I rode on the plane up today with Mike Krzyzewski, my good friend and a wonderful coach, but people don't realize he's a 10 times better person than he is a coach. And we know he's a great coach. He's meant a lot to me in these last 5 or 6 months of my battle. But when I look at Mike, I think we competed against each other as players. I coached against him 15 years. And I always have to think about what's important in life is to think to me of three things: where you started, where you are, and where you're going to be. Those are the three things that I try and do every day. And you know, when I think about getting up and giving a speech, I can't help it. I have to remember the first speech I ever gave. I was coaching at Rutgers University. That was my first job. Wonderful. And I was the freshman coach. That's when freshmen played on freshman teams. And I was so fired up about my first job. I see Lou Holtz, Coach Holtz here. What was it like the first job you had, right? The very first time you stood in the locker room to give a pep talk. That's a special place, the locker room, for a coach to give a talk. So my idol as a coach was Vince Lombardi. And I read this book called Commitment to Excellence by Vince Lombardi. And in the book, Lombardi talked about the first time he spoke before his Green Bay Packer team in a locker room. There were perennial losers. And I'm reading this, and Lombardi said he was thinking, should it be a long talk, a short talk? But he wanted to be emotional. He said, be brief. And this is what he did. He normally you get in the locker room, I don't know, 25 minutes, a half hour before the team takes the field. You do your little X and O's, and then you give the great Newt Rockne talk. We all do. Speech number 84. You pull them right out. You get ready. Get your squad ready. Well, this is the first one I ever gave. And I read this thing, Lombardi. What he said was he didn't go in. He waited. His team was wondering, where is he? Where is this great coach? He's not there. 10 minutes. He's still not there. 3 minutes before they have to take the field, Lombardi comes in, bangs the door open. And I think you all remember what great presence he had, right? Great presence. And he walked in, and he just walked back and forth like this, just staring at the players. And he said, all eyes on me. And I'm reading this in this book, and I'm getting a picture of this Lombardi before his first game. And he said, gentlemen, we will be successful this year. You can focus on three things and three things only, your family, your religion, and the Green Bay Packers. And the rest of it, they knocked the walls down. The rest was history. I said, that's beautiful. I'm going to do that. Your family, your religion, and Rutgers basketball. That's it. I had it. I'm 21 years old. The kids I'm coaching are 19. All right? And I'm going to be the greatest coach in the world, the next Lombardi. And I'm ready. And I'm practicing out right beside the locker room. The manager's telling me, you got to go in. Not yet. Family, religion, Rutgers basketball. All eyes on me. I got it. And now finally he said, 3 minutes. I said, fine. True story. I go to knock the doors open, just like the body. Boom! It didn't open. I almost broke my arm. I was like, it was when it didn't open. Now I'm down. The players are looking. You know, coach, help the coach up. Help him up. You know? And now I did like Lombardi. I walked back and forth, right? And I was going like that with my arm, get the feeling back in it. And finally I said, gentlemen, all eyes on me. And these kids wanted to play. They're 19. Let's go. I said, gentlemen, we'll be successful this year if you can focus on three things and three things only. They said, yeah. I said, your family, your religion, and the Green Bay Packers, I told them. I did that. I remember that. I remember where I came from. It's so important to know where you are. And I know where I am right now. How do you go from where you are to where you want to be? And I think you have to have an enthusiasm for life. You have to have a dream, a goal, and you have to be willing to work for it. I talked about my family. My family is so important. People think I have courage. The courage of my family is my wife, Pam, my three daughters here, Nicole, Jamie, Leanne, my mom, who is right here too. And the screen is flashing up there 30 seconds, like I care about that screen right now, huh? I got tumors all over my body. I'm worried about some guy in the back going 30 seconds, huh? You got a lot. Hey, phenomenal, buddy. You got a lot. All right, get you. Are you kidding me? All right, nuts. I just got one last thing. I urge all of you, to enjoy your life, the precious moments you have, to spend each day with some laughter and some thought, to get your emotions going, to be enthusiastic every day. And Ralph Waldo Emerson said, nothing great can be accomplished without enthusiasm, to keep your dreams alive in spite of problems, whatever you have, to be able to work hard for your dreams to become a reality. Now I look at where I am now, and I know what I want to do. What I would like to be able to do is to spend whatever time I have left and to give and maybe some hope to others. All right, Arthur Ashe Foundation is a wonderful thing. And AIDS, the amount of money pouring in for AIDS is not enough, but it is significant. But if I told you it's 10 times the amount that goes in for cancer research, I also tell you that 500,000 people will die this year of cancer. And I also tell you that one in every four will be afflicted with this disease. And yet, for somehow, we seem to have put it in a little bit of the background. I want to bring it back on the front table. We need your help. I need your help. We need money for research. It may not save my life. It may save my children's lives. It may save someone you love. And it's very important. And ESPN has been so kind to support me in this endeavor. And allow me to announce tonight that with ESPN's support, which means what? Their money and their dollars, and they're helping me. We are starting the Jimmy V Foundation for Cancer Research. And its motto is, don't give up, don't ever give up. And that's what I'm going to try to do. Every minute that I have left, I will thank God for the day and the moment I have. And if you see me, smile and maybe give me a hug, because that's important to me too. But try, if you can, to support, whether it's AIDS or the Cancer Foundation, so that someone else might survive, might prosper, and might actually be cured of this dreaded disease. I can't thank ESPN enough for allowing this to happen, and I'm going to work as hard as I can, you know, for cancer research, and hopefully we'll have some cures and some breakthroughs. And I'd like to think I'm going to fight my brains out to be back here again next year for the Arthur Ashe recipient. I want to give it next year. I know I've got to go. I've got to go. And I've got one last thing. I've said it before and I'm going to say it again. Cancer can take away all my physical abilities. It cannot touch my mind. It cannot touch my heart. And it cannot touch my soul. And those three things are going to carry on forever. I thank you and God bless you all.
That speech is important. It's affected so many. I've had kids come to me and tell me that they've listened to Jimmy's speech as they're battling cancer in hospitals and how it's affected them. I promised a youngster one time, his name is Tony Colton, and he said to me, and I'll never forget it, Mr. V, don't stop. Help kids so they don't have to go through what I'm going through. Those words, and I think about that, because I promised, I said, Tony, to my last breath, I'm gonna beg, I'm gonna plead for dollars to help kids, and that's what I wanna do so badly.
Jimmy's legacy is his battle that he waged against cancer.
There's nothing that means more to me than raising money to help kids battling cancer. That's why I beg you, and I will plead for my last breath, because no child should be doing chemo. We gotta beat this disease, and the only way, we got to get money. Cancer sucks, and we must raise dollars. So please, people, give, give. You may save someone you love.
I helped Jimmy off the stage that day, and like Coach V said, we need your help.
We are gonna battle and battle and battle until one day they have found a cure for cancer. I'm overwhelmed with the love you have shared with me in the battle I face. I love every one of you that have responded, whether it be a text message, whether it be on social media. It's given me so much drive, desire to win this battle, and I will win this battle.
Hey, Dickie V, I've been thinking about you, man.
Hey, Dick, I just want to wish you well.
I know you're going to get through this because you're one of the strongest and most amazing people I know.
You've inspired so many people to donate their time and their money to change kids' lives who face pediatric cancer. Draw their strength through this fight.
I also battled lymphoma, but I made it out, and you can too.
I know you're going to make it through this because you're strong and you have so much positivity.
You know, you got just a whole lot of folks around you supporting you, lifting you up.
You are strong and you are a fighter, and I can't wait to see you back sitting beside me, punching me in the arm.
I cannot wait to be sitting next to you, calling games, watching you take pictures with everybody and their mother.
You're awesome, baby. With a capital A.
We fight for you. We pray for you. We are locked arms with you each and every day, and we will win this.
Be strong, baby. My goodness, did cancer pick the wrong guy to mess with?
Completely confident that you will overcome all that you are enduring, so you're back with us, right where you belong.
Love you, Dick.
I'm going to beat cancer. I'm going to beat it. That's no doubt in my mind. I'm going to win this battle. I'm going to stand at my gala this year and say to that crowd, I am cancer free.
The fight that began one night when one man gave one speech.
Don't give up. Don't ever give up.
So don't give up on me.
It's V-Week on ESPN as we continue Jim Balvano's fight against cancer.
A great night for hoops in Raleigh, North Carolina. As for the first time ever, the Nebraska Cornhuskers and the NC State Wolfpack square off. Both teams with 5 wins coming into this matchup. We're so far in the Big Ten ACC Challenge this year. It's been almost all Big Ten, save for a couple of overtime wins by the ACC. So glad you're with us. Mike Cousins and Corey Alexander along with you. So here's what we do know is that they both have 5 wins, neither against a Power 5 opponent. They've done that without one of their best players on either side. We still have a lot to learn, though, Corey.
You do have a lot to learn about both these teams coming into this game and really facing stiff competition for the first time. But one thing Nebraska knows, they have a stud in freshman Bryce McGowan, who has gotten off to a great start in his career at Nebraska, averaging 17.7 points per game, 25-plus points games already this year. And you look at it, already the fifth-ranked scorer in the Big Ten and fourth among freshmen in Division I.
He's been really solid, as has Darion Sebron, who comes in averaging 19 points, about 10 rebounds a game for the Wolfpack. And through 6 games, he scored the most points by any NC State player since Dennis Smith Jr. back at the start of the 16-17 season. Kevin Keats and this squad now in his 5th year. Across the country, the best improvisers, they say, are in Los Angeles and Chicago. There might be one of the better ones in Raleigh as well inside PNC Arena, as he's had to make a go of it without his better players in the last couple years. Devin Daniels, a torn ACL last year. This year, Manny Bates with a season-ending shoulder injury. And they're off between Nebraska and NC State. Hard contact draws the Cornhuskers out of defensive positioning. Shot clock has dwindled to 10 as Hayes tries to send it off to the wing. And that ends up out of bounds, and Nebraska gets the ball.
And that's uncharacteristic. You're only seeing 4 turnovers all season long from Cam Hayes, and you get one on the first possession of the game against this Nebraska defense.
He's been so solid. We'll see what we get on the other side, too, at the point with Alonzo Verge. He's done a great job there, coming off just a 3-point performance in their win against South Dakota on Saturday, as Nebraska enters on a 4-game winning streak, in which they've been a pretty high-scoring squad, in part because they keep finding good looks for Derek Walker.
And Derek Walker shooting 83% from the field. So when you think about getting him opportunities, he doesn't take many shots. The most he's taken in a game this year, 8 field goal attempts, but he's making the most of every opportunity he gets.
Double-digit points for Walker in their last 4 games on the winning streak. And Morsell and the Wolfpack start off with a couple of turnovers.
And I'm sure that's not what Coach Kevin Keats wanted to see from his team beginning the game, coming out back-to-back turnovers, as you mentioned. But more importantly, his offense is being pushed way out on the floor. Nebraska's pressure causing the Wolfpack to be tentative early in the game.
Here's Verge, the former Arizona State Sun Devil, who sends it from the first marker all the way back outside the 3-point arc for McGowan's, their leading scorer. They've got just 7 on the shot clock. Back to Walker on the interior. And along the baseline, Verge had nowhere to go with it, and it's out of bounds off of NC State with just a 2nd on the shot clock.
If you're NC State right now, you have to take away any opportunities at the rim, put a big defender on the basketball, and then disrupt the view of Verge trying to throw something at the rim.
Good instruction there from Bill Covington, the official along the baseline, and Nebraska had no idea how much time there was on the clock.
Absolutely not. You don't run that play underneath out of bounds with 1 second remaining. Fred Hoiberg not excited about that, but he likes the way his team's gotten off to a start otherwise. And you see the 10-year NBA veteran. We talked with him earlier today, Mike, and of course, we had to go back and reminisce a little bit about who was the shooter in back in the day. Of course, we know that was Fred.
A claim, I think, which you will take in just about any other group except for in the presence of the mayor, as that shot falls for the former Virginia Cavalier, Casey Morsell.
Yeah, I'll give the mayor shooter. Now, we talk everything else. I'm taking that. But I'll give him shooter, no question about it. And his team right now, back-to-back turnovers. And this is where NC State can be extremely dangerous. They haven't scored as much off of turnovers this season as they have in the past. But Kevin Keith's team still wants to pressure you 94 feet and see if they can give you the turnover to basketball.
Even if they're not as deep as they'd like to be, they take pride in being a very well-conditioned team. And Ebenezer Dewana coming off a career scoring game, 10 points in their victory over the weekend against Louisiana Tech. Kevin Keats trying to get back to the NCAA tournament in his first year, the NIT twice in his first four seasons. A lot of traffic along that baseline and not the best of decisions. Hayes comes away with it. Numbers advantage Nebraska, and Hayes scores anyway.
And love the aggressiveness by Cam Hayes early in this game. And, of course, you know, specifically ACC coaches, but most college basketball coaches will tell you the best thing about freshman guards is that they become sophomores, and Cam Hayes stepping it up in his sophomore year.
May have missed a three from the corner. Had an opportunity under the basket, but Verge didn't see him. As he draws two defenders, it's a kick out and a three off front iron for Keon Edwards. Now Helms in transition, spins, and with the left hand, puts NC State up by six.
And outside of the two turnovers to start the game for the Wolfpack, this is just as scripted by Kevin Keats. Pressure, rebounding, and running, getting out in transition, getting easy looks is always a good remedy for an offense.
Hayes tried to step through for the steal. It leads to a dribble through for Verge. Mayen with a three, and the aggression does come back to bite the Wolfpack on that possession.
Well, and that's one of the areas where we talked with Kevin Keats yesterday, and he told us his team has to play more squared up defensively. They can't gamble as much, and putting pressure on that back line without Manny Bates, there's the shot blocker, but that time the gamble gives up a wide open three.
Corey, that was a really fascinating defensive point that Kevin Keats made and that we got him to extrapolate a little bit on was just how they play on defense. There's the three-pointer that goes for Morsell is squaring up without having the epic shot-blocking capabilities of Manny Bates. It's more about keeping your guy in front. Always a goal, but now more of a priority.
It does, and when you don't have the depth along that back line, and of course the ACC's best shot blocker for the last two seasons, that's going to change what you do on the defensive end of the floor. And Kevin Keats' DNA is about pressuring on the perimeter, but now his defenders have to be smarter, like Casey Morsell is stepping in on that possession, protecting the rim and taking the charge.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by Continental Tire. For every surface and every season, Continental Tire has a tire for you. You're watching the Big Ten ACC Challenge on ESPN, presented by Continental Tire. Inside PNC Arena, the third and final night of the challenge, one of six games on the schedule tonight. Nebraska and NC State, each team with five wins. Unfortunately for the Huskers, they've started with four turnovers as the pressure of the Wolfpack, especially along the baseline, has been bothersome. Helms draws two defenders. Hayes works from the top of the key. Shot clock is at 10 as Helms likes that step back, doesn't pull it, but calls for it. Instead, a short contested jumper from Hayes.
Because one of the things we've seen, you know, really over the last few possessions, NC State was 5 for 6. They'll give up an easy one on that possession, but they made 5 of their last 6 buckets after two straight turnovers to start the game. And now they're initiating their offense much closer to the basket. Earlier, Nebraska's pressure was pushing them way out beyond the three-point line.
So is there anything that NC State did to help alleviate that pressure?
Honestly, I believe they just calmed down a little bit. Of course, in a big game like this, and we talked about this is the first opportunity they've really played against, you know, this level of competition outside of Oklahoma State on their home court. And so when you think about that in a big game, of course, you want to win for the ACC. And I think they came out just a bit jittery early.
Cam Hayes has come out ready to shoot.
Yeah, he's had a game where he took 16 field goal attempts, was very aggressive in that loss to Oklahoma State. So he will put it up when he has his opportunities. But and at the same time, he's a capable scorer. The biggest thing for him is making sure the offense runs the way Coach Keats wants it to.
Hellums had the speed advantage on Walker, gets a back rim bounce. It's 13-7 Wolfpack.
I love the attack mode by Jericho Hellums getting to the rim. And, you know, amazing numbers is Cam Hayes, great hands to tap the basketball away from Verge. But you look at Jericho Hellums, who comes in shooting 48% from three, but only shooting 39% overall on the from the field. So you got to think about, these are the type of buckets you need to make to throw in alongside those threes to get that field goal percentage up.
That's the type of number that when you're putting together your sheet to get ready for the game, is Breidenbach off the bench gets the layup, you go, what? Is that a misprint? Better from Absolutely. Three than overall?
Absolutely. You got to go check with somebody. See, that's why I have you. I throw it to you. You let me know if it's legit or not.
That's right. Even if my mother says she loves me, I get a second source. Nebraska turns it over again. Smith off the baseline, leaves that one short. Wiltshire secures the rebound. A wide open look, and that is dangerous. Keisei Tominaga coming off a career high 23, where he hit 5 of 6 from deep. They cannot leave him open.
And you got to be sure, Kevin Keats not happy about the fact that he sees Tominaga knock down a three right in front of their bench.
Gibson had a good look at it. And now Breidenbach with the penetration, and he's called for the offensive foul, the second first half charge taken by NC State.
And without Manny Bates, that's the way the Wolfpack are going to have to defend the rim. But on the previous possession, you see moving the basketball. Well, sorry, that's actually taking care of your rim, stepping in, taking charge. We saw Casey Morsell step in and take one earlier. And this time, Breidenbach, out of control, picks up another offensive foul for the sixth turnover in this game already for Nebraska.
Hellums wanted to go glass over the top of Tominaga. And Nebraska, despite their slow start, propensity for turnovers in the early going, has the opportunity to take the lead. Verge on the roll, had Breidenbach on the mismatch. The Wolfpack recovered defensively. Three from the corner rims out. Wiltshire missed the shot. He gets the deflection. NC State with the ball and a one-point lead on its home court in the Big Ten ACC Challenge.
It's V-Week on ESPN as we continue Jim Valvano's fight against cancer.
NC State football down last Friday to North Carolina. Emeka Emezi catches a 64-yard pass. He had motivation.
It was going slow, but man, I saw something on the videos that said, don't ever give up. You know, they had the ball, they were driving with 6 points up. And I just seen it, I was like, you know what, I'm praying to God, I'm not gonna give up, no matter what. You know what I mean? It was a quick turnaround, and we won, man, I thank God.
Back with you at PNC Arena, Mike Cousins, Corey Alexander for night three on the men's side of the Big Ten ACC Challenge as NC State has opened up a three-point lead over Nebraska. First time that these two teams have met. NC State coming off of a win against Louisiana Tech where they dropped a season-high 90 points. And Nebraska rolls in on a four-game winning streak. Entry pass turned over. Pull-up jumper, 15 feet. Casey Morsell.
And nice play by Casey Morsell, recognizing the defense, trying to retreat, take an offensive foul if he's trying to attack the rim, pulling up 15 feet, just like a layup for Casey Morsell, who's 3 for 3 from the field already.
And that's a shot earlier in his career he probably would not have been encouraged to take.
Different styles, Mike, different styles.
The former Virginia guard now enjoying his time in Raleigh as Breidenbach, the freshman from California out of the fabled modern-day program, Gets the shot to fall, keeps the lead three. Three-pointer is good. With a hand in his face, Terquavion Smith.
And Terquavion Smith is not shy at all. He comes off the bench for NC State, really provides all of their bench scoring for the most part, but he comes in locked and loaded, ready to get looks up every time he steps on the floor.
McGowan's sends it away for Breidenbach, who gets nothing but the back of the rim. Sebron looking for a window to drive. It's Morsell again. Just keep on feeding him.
And you can see the confidence of Casey Morsell growing game by game. Last time out, took 13 field goal attempts, which is a career high for him in a college basketball game. And Kevin Keats talked to us about the fact that he's a guy that he have to continue to work with him on his confidence, letting him know we need you to be aggressive, we need you to score. And Casey Morsell taking the message and excelling here so far tonight.
That's real, right? Because he goes to Virginia, and it is nothing against the style of the Cavaliers, because Tony Bennett has won a national championship. But when you go to any school, you don't have success. Kevin Keats said, it's not unreasonable that you might question your ability, and he still feels like he's unleashing his potential with this team.
Well, anytime you're unsuccessful, you're going to question yourself. So the thing for Casey Morsell really was relocation. He basically found a renewed sense of confidence in this arena with Kevin Keats, with NC State, and he's playing a game some more suited to how he played in high school at St. John's Prep.
Sebron used his length and agility to get to the bucket. His last game at 10 points was his lowest scoring output of the year. It tells you what kind of a start he's had to the year. McGowan's through contact, gets the bucket, and will go to the free throw line.
And you see a flash as to why Bryce McGowan's is special. At 6'7", his ability to weave through traffic and the body control to finish, the concentration and the opportunity for the and one. And McGowan's right now not a knockdown shooter, but he is aggressive when you talk about getting to the basket. You look at the 42 free throws made, which is number one in the Big Ten. And for a freshman to take on that role of attacking the basket says a lot about Bryce McGowan's.
Hayes pestered by McGowan's as he draws him along the exterior of the offensive half. Sebron with a kick to the wing. Huskers looking for their first fast break point, and they'll keep on searching for it as it's knocked away by Sebron with great hustle for the back tip.
But you see the ACC steals leader doing exactly what he does best. Darion Sebron, who's averaging close to 19 points per game, but he does it with all the hustle stats. And you think about getting out in the passing lanes, 2.7 steals per game. And of course, he plays hard every possession. Part of the reason why Kevin Keats loves him so much and gives him such a green light to get it done offensively.
Don't discount that deflection there from Hayes as McGowan's tried to pass it off, and Verge gets the drive to the basket, lays it in for two.
And now you see why Kevin Keats has changed the defensive philosophy just a bit for NC State, because you think about the point guard attacking the basket, finishing over the top of defenders. If Manny Bates is in the game, you know, unfortunately he was injured 57 seconds into this new season, that shot starts a break off the glass by the block shot from Manny Bates.
Yeah, that is a totally different feeling for the guards to know that right behind them, they've got one of the best shot blockers in the country. Probably might have prevented that drive as well from McGowan's, who is fearless rising to the rim.
But you, at this point now, if you're Kevin Keats, you're talking to your team about, guys, we've got to square up, we've got to stay in front of guys because we don't have Manny Bates on that back line. We've got to make sure we take care of our business on the perimeter. And speaking of taking care of business, Bryce McGowan's has found his rhythm here in the first half, attacking the rim once again for the finish, getting the Huskers within four.
Both teams shooting almost 60% to get this game started, but nobody's had a better first half to this point than Casey Morsell, who's dropped 10 for NC State.
When this is the Casey Morsell that we expected to see as a four-star recruit coming into University of Virginia. However, it's taken 2 years, but he's found that confidence shooting the basketball, not only from beyond the arc, but attacking the basket as well as getting to the mid-range. And Casey Morsell off to a great start to start the night here for the Wolfpack.
Their defense has been excellent so far. Morsell denied an assist as Jalen Gibson couldn't finish from point-blank range. It's Verge going to work on Morsell in the wing. Feed into the paint, and the layup goes to the left side for Walker, who, when he's that close, does not miss.
Yeah, Walker, great body control right there, but also recognizing where the shot blockers were on that possession, using the rim. And this is just great footwork and great awareness by the big. Nice interior passing as well. You see Walker avoiding the shot blockers, using the opposite side of the rim with the left hand to finish and make this a one possession game.
You talked about his footwork there. There's a danger in putting the ball on the floor, isn't there?
There really is, especially when you've got so many people converging on the interior. And that's what we saw early in this game for Nebraska. Too many hands in the painted area trying to make those interior passes. That time Walker did a great job not putting it on the floor and just using great footwork to finish underneath.
Huskers trying to take the lead. Their only one of the first half was the first bucket of the game, 2-0. Hayes gets into the paint in traffic, too much. Had his hands on it. And a feed ahead for McGowans, who lays it in and ties it up at 27.
And you see Bryce McGowan stays in attack mode, getting to the rim, finishing it off, and getting easy buckets in transition. And that's how Nebraska wants to play. Fred Hoiberg told us they want to play with pace. They want to make sure they get as many opportunities to score as possible, coming in averaging 80.5 points per game in this four-game winning streak.
Hellum steps through two defenders, nearly puts it in. Strong offensive rebound yields two free throws as NC State, Darion Sebron, aggressive on the glass.
But getting out in transition, Bryce McGowan's protecting the basketball and then finishing. And you can see right now, plays well beyond his years. You're talking about a freshman making plays as such, as McGowan's has taken the Big Ten by storm. 17.7 points per game, 25 in his debut, only to be backed up by 29 the second time out. And he's been a special performer so far for Fred Hoiberg.
A late slate of games and on ESPN, the ESPN app, 9:30 Eastern. We continue with number 24, Michigan and North Carolina. It's a great battle of big men there at the Smith Center in Chapel Hill. Michigan 4-2. They've lost to Seton Hall in Arizona, looking for a good early season win. And North Carolina, after dropping games against Purdue and Tennessee in the Hall of Fame tip-off in Connecticut, got a win last Tuesday against UNC Asheville. This is a great portion of the season where we're into the first full month of the college basketball season to get a true evaluation against power conference teams of where you think you might stack up.
And Cuzzo, where you talked about the battle of big men between Michigan and North Carolina tonight, those two guys, when you consider Armando Bacot and Hunter Dickinson, teamed up with what guard on the floor do you think today to win a Peach Jam championship for Team Takeover?
You know, I'd love to tell you that I could remember it was Casey Morsell, but all I remember from being inside the Athletic Center there in North Augusta, South Carolina, is how cold I was. And that's it. The Riverview Park Activity Center is it's a great place, though.
Well, you were correct in saying Casey Morsell.
And you just also get the DMV player, yeah. Well, you don't have a good shot, create one. And Alonzo Verge did it.
Well, everything has been working for Nebraska inside the three-point line, shooting over 70% from two in this game thus far. So they're getting what they want when they attack the basket. And again, if you can't find one, create one.
Morsell. Surprised that there perhaps was not a flop warning called there, and I'm not sure exactly what the gesticulation from Ted Valentine was in reference to along the sideline.
Well, I will say that Casey Morcell did sell the call. However, he was going to get hit regardless. So the defender was going to run into Casey Morcell, was going to be a foul. I think Casey Morcell may have added a bit to it to try to make sure he got the call, but I believe that was going to be a call regardless.
So let's see the flourish on the foul.
Well, you see Mayen coming out, and he jumps. He's going to hit Casey Morcell. Now, Casey Morcell does stick out the right leg, as of course demonstrated.
He went full jump man on that.
Yeah, absolutely. But he was going to get fouled on that shot. When a defender lunges towards you shooting a three, more often than not, they're going to make contact with the shooter who's going straight up and down.
Second foul on Mayen. He's got two of the Nebraska five. Officials tonight, Ted Valentine, a Final Four official, Bill Covington and Tony Henderson at PNC Arena. All the way down, waiting in the corner to shoot the three, hit it and get the foul. It's Tome Naga. He's made two threes, and both times he's been lost by the Wolfpack defenders.
And just a kick ahead, Casey saying, find me in the corner and give me all three of these, and let's add one more for four, as he knocks down the opportunity for the four-point play to see if he can finish it off. And I love the fact that he's knocked down two of those right in front of the NC State bench. That's when you really know you can do it, Mike. When you shoot in front of the other team's bench, that's the confidence I like to see coming on the road.
When you're celebrating in a vulnerable horizontal position in front of the opposing bench, you really have nerves of steel.
you think this is the 90s? Come on, man. Today, you can do whatever you want. You've got opposing teams storming other people's courts, storming other people's fields. The game has changed, Mike.
Don't sneeze on somebody. It could be a foul.
No, that's different.
That's just rude. I'm Mike Cousins with Corey Alexander. And what has been a tight affair throughout, Nebraska and NC State meeting for the first time. Wolfpack 5-1, a loss against Oklahoma State on their ledger. Nebraska 5-2. They've lost two games by a combined 9 points, by 8 to Creighton and 1 to Western Illinois. Tome Naga left Morcell on the floor, missed the three-point opportunity. Here comes Sebron on the break. It's 3-on-2. He's all the way to the rim, and a blocking foul is the call. He'll shoot free throws.
And if you want to see pace, this is the game to watch. Both these teams love to get up and down the floor. And you see Darius Sebron, who was tied for first at 9.8 rebounds per game in the ACC to lead the league. But his ability to be able to push the basketball and transition a one-man fast break gets him to the free throw line, where he has also lived this year for the Wolfpack.
This is going to make me perhaps a hater or a skeptic, because you can't argue with the result of getting to the free throw line. Would you have advised passing the ball there in a 3-on-2?
Absolutely not. Not when you're this guy. I mean, again, when you're talking about, it's not only the fact that he got the rebound, but he pushed it. And what's the cardinal rule of basketball? Stop the ball. No one stops the ball. You have to continue to attack the basket. And if you can get all the way to the rim off of a rebound, that's the fault of the defense.
It can be baffling when you see nobody step in front to stop the ball. Case in point is that run to the rim by Alonzo Verge. What happened?
I'm sure both these coaches will have a conversation with their teams about transition defense at halftime. But right now, you know, no one recognizing and picking up the ball. And both these teams want to pick up in the full court. So there is pressure in the backcourt. But once it gets to the front court, there's been no resistance at the rim.
Hayes driving to the free throw line, has it taken away by Verge, who starts the break. Tome Naga stepped into a three-point look, gave it up. It's Verge down the lane, off the window for two. Nebraska up 37-33.
And of course, it's beating a dead horse, but if you consider that Manny Bates the best shot blocker in the ACC the last two seasons, unable to play, only 57 seconds of action this year. This would not happen if Manny Bates is on the floor. You're not going to get all these easy layups.
Great hands, three opportunities at the rim. A fourth is wiped away. Sebron comes away unsuccessful, and the Cornhuskers look to add to their largest lead of the night. McGowan's stopped at the rim. The fast break opportunities continue. A jump stop into the lane, saved by Tome Naga. We've got a timeout, Nebraska. Everybody might need to catch their breath in Raleigh. 37-33 with the Cornhuskers trying to stretch their winning streak to five games tonight. .253 to go before the half in Raleigh, the Big Ten ACC Challenge. One of six games tonight, and Nebraska up 37-33, 4 points, their largest lead, and the points in the paint, they're doubling up the Wolfpack.
And they have gotten easy looks, and that's not something that Kevin Keats is used to seeing from his team when he has a guy like Manny Bates on that back line, the ACC's leading shot blocker the last two seasons. But when you think about it, we talked with Coach Keats, and he simply said, we had to change our defensive philosophy on the perimeter. We can no longer force players to their weak hand and give them a free run to the rim because we don't have that shot blocker behind us. So we've got to square guys up, keep them out of the painted area, and that has not worked for the Wolfpack here tonight.
Tome Naga lost it. It belongs to NC State. As a defender in that scenario, does that make your job harder?
Well, it does, because you have to make sure you slide your feet and keep your defender in front of you without fouling. And one of the things that NC State does not have this year is tremendous depth. That's one of the things that Kevin Keats really has had more so in his past four seasons. But they don't have a lot of depth to get in foul trouble, but they do have Jericho Helms knocking down threes at a very high clip this season.
He splashes it through up to 7 points behind only Casey Morcell, who's got 12 and has yet to miss a basket.
You know, and part of the other thing with him, Mike, is when you prepare in your preseason, you know, you're talking all summer long, and then you say September through November, we're going to play one way, and then, of course, you get your shot blocker hurt and you have to change everything 1 minute into the season. That's going to take some adjustment. So again, you can't expect for NC State to be great at that right now at this phase of the season, but it's something they're going to have to improve on as the season goes along.
It'd be like if I told you we were going to have a Thanksgiving dinner with chicken and turkey and ham, and then on a couple days notice I said, actually, you know what, it's a vegan Thanksgiving now. Your plans have drastically changed.
Well, my plan to come to your house has changed, so that's what's going to change for me.
You weren't invited anyway. Helms backs it out. Will he try and drive here on Breidenbach? And it blows right by, 17-footer, halfway down. Offensive board, no. A second chance opportunity doesn't go. But there will be free throws, much to the dismay of the Nebraska bench. And Corey, it's not exceedingly surprising to see that there have been a few possessions now in the last few minutes of game time where the Wolfpack have been vying for a third or fourth opportunity on the offensive glass. The 27th annual Jimmy V Classic in New York City, Tuesday night on ESPN, Texas Tech and Tennessee at 7 Eastern. And then it's old rivals, Villanova and Syracuse. The Orange with Villanova transfer Cole Swider finding his stride on their roster. And if you'd like to donate to the V Foundation, go to V.org. Big game tonight in the city of brotherly love, Villanova and Penn. Don't sleep on a Big Five matchup.
At the Palestra, I'm sure, nothing better than the Big Five in Penn. When you think about the teams that get involved, and regardless of the Villanova being the power school, it's still always competitive when you think Big Five basketball. But Mike, going back to your point about the offensive rebounding, coming into this game, Nebraska, and playing against, honestly, competition that you know, wasn't the most out competition, have been out-rebounded by 45 on the offensive glass in six games. That's close to an average of 8 offensive rebounds advantage for their per game for the teams that they're playing against. So when you imagine coming in and playing against the length and the size of NC State, you know, Fred Hoiberg had that as problem number one as to what they needed to take care of with the Wolfpack in this game. NC State's gotten the offensive boards, but they haven't really converted them into second chance points thus far.
Forty-nine seconds remain in the first half. NC State down one, takes a timeout. Suppose it's a good problem to have coming out of a timeout here with a few possessions left for the Wolfpack, that you've got a lot of good options where to go on offense here.
You really do. And of course, at this point, if I'm Kevin Keats, you definitely want to get the basketball to Casey Morsell or Jericho Helms. Both these guys shooting the basketball very well in this one. And that use it or lose it timeout gives Coach Keats an opportunity to give his guys something to execute, and really more so of a two-for-one situation here. But Fred Hoiberg changing up the defensive coverage, going zone coming out of the timeout.
NC State has missed 9 of its last 10 field goal tries and make it 10 out of 11. Still just a one-point game.
And no two-for-one here. Nebraska can hold it for the final shot. Only tenths of a second separating the shot clock and the game clock.
It's Verge. He draws defenders, kicks to the wing, three-pointer, no good from Wilcher, and 1.8 seconds remain.
Nebraska got the look that they wanted, unable to knock it down, but right now looking for a stop to take a lead in halftime.
Into Sebron, and just shy of Tuffy at midcourt. He sends it awry. Nebraska has the lead despite their turnovers. That's what's helped make it a close game. 39-38 at the half in the first ever matchup between Nebraska and NC State. A great first half for Casey Morsell for the Wolfpack. Walker, McGowans, and Verge on the attack for Nebraska. Take a break. Zubin Mehenti, Sean Farnham will be in studio for our halftime report. The 14th Women's Big Ten ACC Challenge begins tonight, and we'll have a doubleheader tomorrow with number 12 Michigan and number 10 Louisville at 7 Eastern. And then inside Cameron Indoor, it's Duke and number 9 Iowa, both games on ESPN and the app. Tonight inside PNC Arena on the final night of the men's Big Ten ACC Challenge at the half, Nebraska 39, NC State 38. More action on the way. Fred Hoiberg taking his Nebraska Cornhuskers on the road, trying to get a fifth straight win. They're halfway there, 39-38 over NC State. On the third and final night of the Big Ten ACC Challenge. Glad you're back with us, my cousins, Corey Alexander. If you told Fred Hoiberg you're shooting 57% in the first half, you'd say, of course we're going to be winning. You would guess they'd be winning by 1 point, though. They've had trouble turning the ball over.
They really have. They've given away so many possessions, but you have to like the efficiency when they get shots because they're getting so many points in the paint and attacking the basket. The tempo of this game on both sides has been exactly what these coaches have wanted, but the defense has not. When you see the turnovers turning defense into offense for NC State on one end of the floor, but the same thing happening on the other end of the floor for Nebraska, and Casey Morsell doing a great job taking advantage of his opportunities, but Nebraska pushing the ball in transition. NC State not getting back, getting his defense set, giving up wide open looks, and then of course attacking the basket, Bryce Gowans in transition, and right now a combined 22 points, 22 fast break points between both these teams in the first half.
So Nebraska really shooting it well. NC State closed out very cold at the end of the first half. But they've got 8 points from the free throw line, so that's assisted their effort. The leading scorers on both sides each have a dozen. Casey Morsell with that tally for NC State. Alonzo Verge, 12 for Nebraska, and McGowan's the leading scorer on the year for the Huskers, have 7 points. Other games tonight in the challenge as well. Louisville, Michigan State on ESPN. Virginia Tech, Maryland on ESPN2. And following us will be Miami at Penn State. First time that those two teams play since 1995. Looking to feed it inside for Dewana. He got fronted in the post there by Walker. Shot clock is at 10. Hayes works far from the basket. Hellums wants three.
Good look for Hellums, not able to knock it down, but you'll take that look from him every opportunity you get the way he shot the basketball this season.
Verge whips it for Mahan, who cashes in the three-pointer. He came in just 5 of 20 from deep.
Then Nebraska as a team only shooting 28% from beyond the three-point arc. So if you add that to what they've been able to do attacking the paint and inside the three-point line, you've got a dangerous offensive group.
Hellums out for Hayes, straightaway three. Cold streak has continued to open the half for the Wolfpack. That veers toward the sideline. Verge comes away with it. Each team down a man in the backcourt. Hellums and Mahan playing catch-up. This is McGowan's, turned away by Dewana.
Nice play by Dewana. Challenging McGowan's without fouling, coming up with another block shot as he gets another block shot. 5 for him last time out against Louisiana Tech, 2 on one possession.
He slaps it off the backboard, and it turns into a fast break layup for Sebron.
And we mentioned that's what Manny Bates does for this team. He gets NC State out in transition. Oftentimes his block shots stay within the field of play and start to break as Dewana does just that in getting Sebron out into transition for the easy buckets. More fast break points for NC State. Started off the defense.
Sebron, the Wolfpack's leading scorer, only took 4 shots in the first half. Now McGowan's, who's been a much more of a basket shooter tonight, clipped the rim on a 3-point try. Mahan on the drive, finds the basket, quite welcoming.
And Dewana on that possession did not want to commit to Mahan because he didn't want Walker getting another layup.
Sebron missed it. Rebound is tipped out to Tominaga. Looking to break down Morsell. Defensive expert stays in front, and a 3-pointer rattles home Nebraska. Largest lead of the night at 47-40.
And Bryce McGowan's playing with a lot of confidence. The freshman coming on the road, the first time he's had to play in front of a hostile crowd, unfazed, knocking down the three to get him to double digits.
Nebraska with its largest lead as the Wolfpack has missed 13 of 15, but the Huskers, Corey, they just keep putting them down.
Yeah, Nebraska making themselves right at home at PNC Arena, knocking down 2 of their 4 three-point attempts here in the second half. And Bryce McGowan's getting involved in the action from beyond the arc, now 10 points for their leading scorer, and he's playing with a tremendous amount of confidence here on the road.
McGowan's the top scoring freshman in the Big Ten, and the 4th best scoring freshman in all of Division I basketball.
And this is exactly what Kevin Keese did not want to see coming out of the timeout, but great defensive effort there by Casey Morsell, blocking the three from Mahan in the corner and getting the basketball back to the Wolfpack.
So can they turn their defense into offense? Morsell steps into the three. Offensive rebound. Sebron off the window for 2, has 10.
And Darion Seabron, who averages 3 offensive rebounds per game, although he scores close to 19 points a game, he's not a guy you run plays for, but you do run plays to get looks for K-State beyond the arc. Knocks down his third three of the evening.
He's up to 10 points, just 2 points off the team lead for the three-point shooter who's coming off a career-high 23-point performance in their last game. Victory against South Dakota on Saturday by 13. A lowered shoulder is an offensive foul against Seabron.
What cancer cannot touch is my mind, my heart, and my soul. It can't touch those three things. The 83 team taught me about dreaming and the importance of dreams, because nothing can happen if not first a dream. If you have someone with a dream, if you have a motivated person with a dream and a goal and a vision, if you have someone who never gives up, who has great hope, and that team taught me the persistence, the idea of never, ever quitting. Don't ever give up. Don't ever stop fighting.
That was February of 1993, a 10-year anniversary salute to the NC State 83 championship team. And here we are, 2021, almost 2022. It's V-Week at ESPN, and our partnership with the V Foundation highlights the urgent need for cancer research. And you can learn more and help support by visiting v.org/donate, where 100% of your donation goes directly to cancer research. That's v.org/donate.
And of course, Cuzzo, V-Week is huge everywhere. It's worldwide, but nowhere bigger than Raleigh, North Carolina. You think Reynolds Coliseum, you think Jim Valvano. I was fortunate enough to be recruited by Jimmy V before he left in 1990. And I can tell you right now, it was a dream come true to talk to him as a legendary coach. But when he went on to ESPN and was calling games, that was also a dream come true to get to just meet him and be around him, you know, as he was battling cancer, but yet still such an inspiration to so many.
What was he like recruiting you?
Oh, he was the best. He held court. When he walked into a room, everyone stopped what they were doing and just listened to Coach Valvano. There are stories about him, and of course, I wasn't at Oak Hill when he was recruiting me, but there are stories about him at Oak Hill where he would go to restaurants, and there aren't many restaurants in Martha Wilson, Virginia.
But he would go, cell phone service. Either,
yeah. Yeah, he would go to restaurants and, you know, hey, he'd buy out the bar. And he would hold court almost like as though he was performing, you know, in restaurants. And people would know that he was there and, you know, go home and get friends. And everyone would just come out and just listen to stories and listen to him talk. And again, you know, Jimmy V was the best, man. Again, just the opportunity to be around him. The one thing I've saved from my recruiting was a flyer or a pamphlet that NC State sent me in 1989 when he was still the coach. That's how much respect I have for Jim Valvano.
That is so cool. And every year when we get the opportunity, I mean, you could watch it any day you want of his speech from the ESPYs, but watch it every week around this time or every year around this time. I watched this week just washing the dishes for like 10 minutes, and I was like, you know what? This is the most effort I'm going to put into washing the dishes that I've ever done, because it's just that type of charisma that really gets you going. And we hope that everyone watching at home is able to channel that effort and give whatever you can, no matter how small. That donation helps make a difference. Along with Corey Alexander, the former Virginia and NBA guard, Mike Cousins with you. Night 3 of the Big Ten ACC Challenge. Nebraska, its largest lead of the night. They've stretched it out to 10. Mahan wants more. His three almost went down and swatted by Walker. It ends up in the hands of Morsell.
In danger area for NC State. They've gone cold on the offensive end of the floor. Have to find a way to get stops and see if they can put pressure on 94 feet with Nebraska. See if they can start turning them over. But without making shots, you can't set up that pressure. And it's been a struggle here in the second half for the Wolfpack.
They're without any points now in almost 2.5 minutes. And they're just one of their last 7 as the Huskers have gone from down 9 to up by 10. Sebron drives and kicks for Helms. His three rattles out. As good a look as you could hope for, off by millimeters.
Yeah, that's the second time we've seen a shot go touch every part of the rim for Helms and not go down. But we have seen Bryce McGowan stay in attack mode. Another opportunity for the and one, getting out in transition. NC State not really setting their defense. Galvin's going through five white jerseys to get the and one opportunity.
Tawana sits for the Wolfpack as the former South Carolina Gatorade Player of the Year goes to the line. Number 26 in the ESPN 100 in the class of 2021. Had originally committed to Florida State, but got sold by his brother Trey and assistant Matt Abdelmassi, who's a great recruiter on this staff for Fred Hoiberg.
Yeah, his buddy John Butler did end up at Florida State, and of course Bryce and John train with my guy Shimon Williams, who is not very popular in Raleigh, but is in the Tar Heel State, playing down the road at North Carolina, one of their all-time greats. And Bryce McGowan's picking up a lot of Shimon's aggressiveness attacking that basket, as does his brother Trey. Yeah, we really haven't mentioned much about the fact that Nebraska is doing this without Trey McGowan.
That's right, he's out with a broken right foot, the transfer from Pittsburgh, who suffered that just about 2 weeks ago yesterday, and they're hoping to have him back by mid-January is the prediction there from the athletic training staff. Eight minutes into the second half and just three made field goals by NC State. Foul is the third on the big man Breidenbach.
An opportunity to see Trey McGowan's big brother cheering on his squad, and Trey starting out the season playing in the first three games, injured in the game against Creighton, the foot injury. As you mentioned, Nebraska hopes to get him back in January, where they'll be right in stride in Big Ten play, and you need that veteran presence on your squad then. But they've handled their business very well here on the road thus far. 13-point lead over the Wolfpack in hostile territory.
They've looked sharp for a team that has not fared well in Big Ten play the last couple of years. Feeling good against a power conference team tonight.
Bryce McGowan's finding his way to the rim early and often, attacking the basket to the tune of 13 points for the fourth leading scoring freshman in the country. And he has been in attack mode all night long, and a big basket there for NC State. Cam Hayes getting the easy layup, but you look at freshman scoring leaders this season. NC State will face three of those five thus far. Played against Kenneth Lofton Jr., who went for 36 points and 18 rebounds against the Wolfpack last time out against Louisiana Tech. And of course, big rivalry game with Paolo Banchero and the Duke Bluebells throughout this season.
Duke fell on the road last night against Ohio State. Had a big second half lead, but it was the Buckeyes who came away victorious, which opens the door perhaps for Purdue to be the number one team in the country come next Monday. That is if the Boilermakers can take care of business on Friday against Iowa.
Because if you go back to the last play and you see how easy it was for Verge to just get to the rim, zero resistance. And this is a straight line drive, but you look at Darion Sebron, and he is actually forcing to the middle to what would be considered the weak hand of Verge. That is how Kevin Keats taught their defense in the preseason. Once Manny Bates was injured, they made the switch. You have to square up your offensive player, but yet that wasn't the case, and you see just a straight line drive to the basket for an easy bucket to increase the lead to 13 for Nebraska.
So there's definitely a blame to be placed on the primary defender on that play, but what about the four other defenders, guys who could come over and help, and nobody did?
Well, I mean, and of course, there's definitely a responsibility from those four defenders, but when you go straight line, it happens so quickly because, again, you also have to stay attached to guys who can knock down threes on the opposite side of the floor. You can't just walk away from your defender. You sell out at the end eventually. But up until that point, there are really, you know, there's a certain level of discipline you have to have staying connected to your man.
Just nothing dropping for the Wolfpack. Helms realizing that with perimeter shots not falling, better to try a higher percentage look closer to the basket. And now he'll get his opportunity from the free throw line. Helms shooting just 4 of 12, and he's made 1 of 6 three-point tries. And the first free throw is no good. NBA Friday doubleheader to start your weekend on ESPN and the app. Joel Embiid and the Sixers play the second of their four-game road trip against Trae Young and the Hawks. And then Mike Woodson and the Clippers square off against Kurt Rambis and the Lakers at the Staples Center. Our coverage starts with NBA Countdown at 7.
This is how NC State's going to try to find a way to get back into it. The full court pressure, you have to score to be able to set it up. But see if they can get Nebraska into some of the silly turnovers that they had in the first half. Nebraska with 11 first half turnovers has handled the basketball extremely well here in the second half. But a lot of it has to do with the fact that they've got the easy looks right at the rim.
Verge, short corner fadeaway, good for Kobe Webster. Neither team shooting it particularly well from three today. Nebraska at 30%, NC State at 20%. But the Huskers have used all options tonight. Sebron got loose on the baseline for the dunk.
But when you consider Nebraska shooting 54% from the field throughout this game, when you're making twos at that high of a clip, you don't really need the three as much.
Wolfpack get the turnover they've been looking for. It's a 4-on-2 break, but it all belongs to one, Darion Sebron.
And that's what the Wolfpack have to do to get back into this, see if they can continue to put some pressure on Nebraska, get turnovers, turn their defense into offense, and make this a game here on their home court.
McGowan's took the screen. The defensive rotation forced a miss. And a contact too close there as Wiltshire in a collision is called for the foul. But it may be more than just that. Sebron is down on the court for the Wolfpack. Holding his right knee after that collision with Wiltshire as the Wolfpack were looking to run the break.
Of course, this is the time where you're hoping it's just guys bang knees as Sebron stays down. Fortunately, and again, you hope this is the case, but that was two guys banging knees. And you would much prefer to see there be contact than a non-contact injury in that standpoint. So we are hoping that that's going to be a bruise in comparison to anything structural.
Timeout, 8:47 to go. Come right back to PNC Arena in 30 seconds. A timeout at PNC Arena. NC State's leading scorer, Darion Sebron, is down, his right knee being looked at by Ron Cooper, the athletic trainer, Kevin Keats, his head coach out there as well, on this collision on the fast break with C.J. Wiltshire.
And you see Wiltshire's left knee banging directly to the inside of Sebron's knee. And, of course, right now, Darion Sebron doesn't feel like that's a positive But for us looking, it's always a positive when it's a contact injury and you can see the collision in comparison to being non-contact and you question whether it's structural. So prayerfully, that's going to be something that Darion Sebron can ice up and still continue to play basketball.
So he'll retreat to the locker room to get that looked at in the bowels of the arena. It's a 61-51 lead for Nebraska as NC State and the Cornhuskers play for the first time here on night number three of the Big Ten ACC Challenge. Largest lead of the night for State was 9. The biggest lead for Nebraska has come here in the second half at 14 points. It was 61-47. The last four belong to the Wolfpack. And we've got a wedgie.
And everything was going in the right direction for the Wolfpack until the injury to Sebron. They have built some momentum, getting out in transition, scoring, and allowing themselves to set up their defense, especially in the full court. And right now, without Sebron on the floor, Jericho Helms, Cam Hayes, step it up. Someone has to take over a leadership role and playing as hard as Sebron does to try to continue that momentum.
Hayes has 10 on the shot clock. The defender draped on his shoulder. He puts it up and in. And one for Cam Hayes.
And Cam Hayes with the answer, making it an 8-point game opportunity to get it down to 7, getting inside the teeth of the Nebraska defense, finishing through the contact. And now you see the opportunity to not only make this a 7-point game, but with a made free throw, allow the Wolfpack to set up that full court defense.
Hayes now has a 6th straight game with at least 10 points as his total is up to 11, and the Wolfpack are on a 6-0 run, now with 8:05 to play. McGowan spins through the defense, whips it to the perimeter, 3-pointer, bounces high off the hands of Webster.
But another offensive rebound. If NC State, you've got to finish possessions, especially if you're trying to make a comeback.
Webster from the free throw line fades away. Hayes has the rebound, wants to press the issue up the floor. Darion Sebron back in the bench area for the Wolfpack after banging his knee with C.J. Wilcher. Whether he'll return, who can say? But the Wolfpack are on the comeback trail for certain. So good news for NC State. Darion Sebron cleared to return to this game after a knee-to-knee collision with C.J. Wilcher. It'll take everybody in the comeback effort here as they led by as many as 9, now trail by 7 against the Cornhuskers on their home court.
And Sebron with 14.7 rebounds in this game has been a difference maker, especially here in the second half. And more importantly, his defensive effort in pushing the tempo off of his rebounds has changed the pace of play for NC State. And for the Wolfpack Nation, I'm sure they're hoping he's going to step back into this game here relatively soon.
It was earlier in the half a 14-point Nebraska lead. Verge to McGowan's. He works on Hayes. Step back three. No.
Opportunity for NC State here to make this a one-possession game. You want to make sure you get a quality look, and of course you cannot afford a turnover at this juncture with momentum on your side.
Marcel puts it on the deck with contact. He lays it in, 61-58.
I love the play by Casey Marcel, not settling for a jump shot, attacking the basket, challenging the shot blocker at the rim.
And Burge right the other way says, I can do that too, as it finds Walker under the basket. And as he was looking for an assist, instead he turns it over.
But look at the defensive energy by NC State. Now this possession in comparison to what we've seen throughout the majority of this game. Duana coming up with the block shot, and now an opportunity for NC State to tie if they're able to knock down a three. And of course, the Wolfpack with an 11-0 run over the last 3:15.
Hayes off the screen, throws to the corner. Helms ties it at 61. And we've got all sorts of chaos in front of the NC State bench.
In game action, it was a beautiful find from Cam Hayes to Jericho Helms, who's been shooting a hot basketball from three. And we talked about celebrating in front of the opposing team's bench. However, in front of NC State's bench, Mayen takes a shot at Jericho Helms, causing a bit of ruckus in front of the bench. And I believe the officials will have to take a look at what caused the melee for a bit there, and that was solely started by Mayen with the forearm to Jericho Helms, who was celebrating with his teammates, knocking down the three. I would not be surprised if there were a technical foul called on Mayen coming out of this review with the officials.
And the first thing that I saw was Mayen, number 11, chirping right into the face of Cam Hayes as well, coming up along that bench.
Well, Mayen's talking to his teammates at this point, but as he goes to the bench, he just bumps Jericho Helms. That's what initiated the issue. And so at that point, Cam Hayes comes over to protect his teammate. That's where it escalates. But this issue was started by Mayen. He was originally talking to his teammates, though, so the first conversation were his teammates on the defensive rotation. Cam Hayes coming over and protecting his teammates, but again, who knows what will come from this? However, we know where the instigator was in this scenario, and of course, with the great video that we have, I'm sure the officials are seeing that. They will see the same instigation.
The officials tonight, Ted Valentine, Bill Covington, Tony Henderson, inside PNC Arena, taking a look because you understand where things started, but it's also a matter of figuring out what transpired after that initial shoulder bump, too, to see if there are any other penalties to be given.
But this could be a huge swing. Not only does NC State knock down the three to tie the basketball game, if a technical foul is assessed and you get two free throws on this, this could be a five-point possession for the Wolfpack.
Class A technical foul, by definition, unsportsmanlike conduct or behavior by a player, coach, or bench personnel. As you said, two free throws, and play resumes at the point of interruption, which was after the three by Helms to tie it at 61. Well, it's certainly in a frenetic game, an opportunity for everybody to catch their breath here, but that doesn't mean when they come back out that emotions will have simmered very much.
Oh, they won't. This game has taken on a new level of emotion. Now, when you have that type of interaction going on between the two teams, it's going to be chippy for the remainder of this game. Of course, you've got a great officiating crew on the court here tonight who definitely can handle this. But when you consider after that mix-up, it's going to be a lot of emotion shown over this last 6:09 remaining.
Yeah. Pass looks like a disqualification.
He's gone. Ted Ballantyne ejecting Mahan from the game.
So no free throws is what Ted Ballantyne says.
I believe someone from NC State has also...
So what we're told is that it was a double technical foul. Lat Mahan for Nebraska, Cam Hayes for NC State, and the disqualification of Mahan. The tide has turned in several directions here over the last few minutes. NC State watched Darion Sebron writhing in pain, holding his knee after a collision as they were down double digits earlier in this half. Now they've come back to tie it up and the ejections are getting sorted out. This was a three-pointer by Helms to tie the game. And then he gets a shoulder from Lat Mahan at the top of your screen, and that's where things broke down.
But you have to see who comes in. Do guys leave the bench? Look at everyone leaving the bench and getting involved. And now there's pushing and shoving, players falling down. And so there may be more than one ejection. We see Cam Hayes now headed to the locker room. He's been ejected from this game. And at this point, the officials going through the list of guys. I believe Verge has been ejected for Nebraska. And everyone, so now you're seeing the guys running off of the bench have been ejected as well.
Well, we know it was a thorough video review if they're ejecting people who aren't even playing.
But that's a rule. I mean, when you consider, there's no way you can run from the end of the bench. You're not even involved in the game. And get up off the bench, run from the end of the bench into a crowd. That's not going to be acceptable. And of course, the officials doing a great job here of going back and identifying everyone that was involved in the melee and getting them off of the court and out of the playing area.
Corey, did you see the player coming over from the Nebraska bench with the knee scooter? Like, what are you going to do on a knee scooter coming over to a fight?
Well, I have to say, I know exactly who that player was. There's only one guy on a knee scooter, and that would be Trey McGowan's. But when you see, and so think, look at the Trey McGowan's coming over. And now, to his credit, he's not coming in to be a part of the problem, but yet still by leaving the bench. And of course his little brother is involved in the scrum, so that's big brother coming over to protect. So it's going to be interesting to see who actually is still available in this game, as we know both Cam Hayes and Mahan have been ejected, and we're going to see a number of substitutes in the game from here on out.
And double technicals assessed as well. 61 all, 6 minutes to play. And they'll take it down the stretch as Nebraska tries for its fifth straight win. A couple of five-win teams here tonight. A hard-fought layup, 63-61 from McGowan's.
And Darion Sebron back on the floor, now running the point. McCam Hayes ejected from this game. Verge does remain on the floor for Nebraska. I thought he was one of the guys ejected, but he was not. So have to make sure we correct that.
Oh,
At this point, we're still trying to gather all the information as to who has been ejected. For both teams.
It seems like we're not the only ones trying to figure that out. So Bill Covington summoned by the scorer's table as they figure out the entire adjudication of that melee near midcourt.
Well, I believe the confusion is as to whether or not one of the players participating was actually on the list of ejections. We got a list that did include one player that's actually on the court who Bill Covington is actually talking to right now. But he apparently was not ejected.
All right, so everybody's good for the time being. And the free throw from Smith makes it 63-62. By the way, we still have a night slate of games, a late night slate to go. Six games tonight, three more with 9:30 Eastern time scheduled starts. Tomenaga waits out a leaping defender, clangs back rim, and Morcell starts the break for the Wolfpack, the opportunity to retake the lead. Morcell with a shot fake, couple of dribbles on the baseline, and a hard foul as Sebron back into the game, goes up and gets fouled.
But you love to see Sebron still attacking the rim. The knee is fine and making plays to try to help his team win. A great backdoor cut and a beautiful find from Casey Morcell, getting Sebron back to the line and an opportunity to regain the lead for the Wolfpack.
Corey, I don't know about you, but when Sebron went down earlier with that knee-to-knee collision with CJ Wilcher, it didn't look like he was going to come back in the game, just the amount of pain he was in. And he went off to the locker room, came back, got cleared, and here's the ejections. Cam Hayes for NC State, Lat Mayen and Kobe Webster, significant contributors tonight, McPherson not. But here we are, 64-63, play with what you got down the stretch.
And so, of course, to combat your point, Cuzzo, I knew he was coming back in because it was a bang knee.
Another
three.
Another one for Tomenaga.
Casey knocking down three after three, and you can see that this young man is having a great time playing basketball and taking advantage of his opportunities. We talked about a career-high 23 for him coming off the bench last time out, and now he continues his hot shooting here, his fourth three-pointer in this one.
Hellum's corner nearly does it again. He tied the game from that spot. And a foul goes on Nebraska underneath the basket.
But getting back into the mix, Darion Sebron coming up with another offensive rebound, putting pressure on Nebraska's defense to try to find a way to keep him off the glass. We talked at the beginning about how Nebraska had been beaten up on their own defensive glass all year long. In seven games coming into this one, they had been out-rebounded by 45 to their opponents. And Darion Sebron continues that trend here tonight.
Wolfpack keeping themselves in this from the free throw line. They are 16 of 19 at the stripe today.
Because of, although Sebron will not get credited for offensive rebound on that possession because it was a foul, he still has five offensive boards in this game. You're talking about a young man who had to take an exit with a knee injury, but coming back in playing with the same level of aggressiveness.
Yeah, he's on the verge of yet another double-double. That is goaltending. Keisei Tomenaga was playing at Ranger College, the junior college level. Nebraska found him. What a welcome addition. A great three-point shooter. ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by Continental Tire. For every surface and every season, Continental Tire has a tire for you. And
In this game tonight between Nebraska and NC State, we've covered almost every possible scenario of what can happen, good and bad, and a goaltend on the last trip down the floor called on Ebenezer Dwana of NC State gave two to Nebraska to make their lead go back to 3-68-65. With Corey Alexander, I'm Mike Cousins. Final night of the Big Ten ACC Challenge. Darion Sebron keeps on bringing it. He's got 19, a game high.
And Sebron continues to attack the paint, puts pressure on Nebraska's defense every time down the floor, and now will take over the role as the point guard for NC State with Cam Hayes out of this game. And finds himself in a great point guard duel with Alonzo Verge, who has led Nebraska not only in scoring, but in rebounds and assists in this game. And Verge getting it done to the tune of 18-7-6 already, showing up big for the Huskers.
So if you're joining us late, there was a fight in front of the NC State bench that led to the ejections of Kobe Webster and Matt Layen for Nebraska, Cam Hayes for NC State. Here's Helms on the break, collects himself, but he traveled first. Tony Henderson blows the whistle and sends the ball back the other end.
And Helms traveled because you called that a fight. That's why. He was distracted by you calling it a fight, and he heard you say that right in the middle of this, and it forced him to travel. That's your fault that Jericho Helms traveled on that fast break. He heard you. That's not a fight, Cuzzo. In a fight, punches have to be thrown. That was just a little mixed up.
That tells you how many fights I've been in my life.
Very true.
Zero.
Very true.
Walker outside his scoring range, puts it on the floor. A deep three try. No good from Tominaga. 68-67. Huskers, 2.5 to play. All the way to the basket. Sebron, no, tries to save it, and he gifts it to Walker. A feed ahead. It's Verge, left block. Offensive foul. Helms takes it to the chest.
And Verge is pointing to the restricted area arc. However, as a primary defender, you can still take a charge. It's the secondary defender that cannot. So although Helm's feet are on the restricted area, as a primary defender, he can step in and take that charge. You see Verge clearly lowers the shoulder. Great call by the officiating crew on that possession.
And great explanation by you, Corey.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much.
Some players have not left the building. They have left the floor. And the star right now is Sebron. Wolfpack lead with 2 minutes to go. Verge drives on Morcell. Off glass, no. Boarded by Walker. They've got another 20 seconds to work with. Tominaga rejected by Dwana. Helm straight away. Sebron, 8 on the shot clock. Forced out near midcourt. It's Helms. And Morcell, an off-balance three, no good. Offensive rebound, NC State, put back try, and a foul. A tireless effort from Smith.
And Wolfpack Nation on their feet, getting it done on both ends of the floor. Taquavion Smith coming up with the offensive rebound. But it's been Darion Sebron attacking the basket, getting to the rim, the finish, and of course, always important, finding the camera after the beautiful finish. But give credit to Dwana on the other end of the floor. 5 block shots for him on the evening. Let me correct that. 4 block shots for him on the evening, but continuing his stellar play here in the second half, where resistance at the rim was non-existent for the Wolfpack in the first half. DeJuan has been great protecting the rim here in the second stanza.
Three-pointer rims out for Wilcher. Now NC State can draw the clock down. Nebraska with 10 minutes to go, led by 14 points. But the Wolfpack have not lost a regular season home game against a non-conference opponent in the last 27 times out. Takes you all the way back to 2017, Kevin Keats' first season, and they're determined to keep that streak alive. Still a nightcap to come after us. Three more games to go. The game you'll see immediately after this one here, Miami, Penn State, will be starting on the ESPN app. And we'll get you there right after things are done from a raucous PNC Arena.
So right now, Kevin Keyes, 22 seconds remaining on the shot clock. You want to get a quality look. But the difference is you've got your primary playmaker, Cam Hayes, ejected from the game. Now Darion Sebron, who's a great finisher, is now your primary ball handler. If you can get a look for Jericho Helms beyond the three-point arc here and get him a good look, you want to take advantage of that. Otherwise, you want to make sure you get Sebron attacking the basket, getting to the rim, possibly getting fouled, where NC State has been great getting to the free throw line, and Sebron scoring big here in this second half. So Sebron should have the basketball in his hands to make a play for himself. But if he has Jericho Helms open, get him the basketball, see if he can knock down a three and make this a two possession game.
Sebron, 21 points tonight. 15 of them have come in the second half.
And this is the action to get the basketball in Sebron's hand, go pick and roll.
He gets pushed out high by Walker. Helm steps through on the fake, pushed it long. Shot clock is off. Here come the Huskers. It's a 5-on-4 for Nebraska. Verge to the rim, lays it in. The Huskers take the lead, 70-69. And yet another Wolfpack injury, as we saw Sebron go down earlier in the half. And it looks like Morcell holding his left leg.
Casey Morcell grabbing that left ankle. Being attended to, and of course got off to a great start in this game. Very difficult if he can't continue for the remaining 17 seconds, as you see Morcell getting caught up, trips over Sebron, but still gets back in the play. But it's right there, stepping on the back of Verge's foot, trying to retreat. You see him go down, rolling that left ankle. 16.6 remaining, not having Casey Morcell on the court is a threat, could be tough for the Wolfpack on the last possession.
Virginia Tech in what was a close game throughout, picking up a win against Maryland. And so after overtime wins yesterday for the ACC, Wake Forest had just one overtime against Northwestern. Syracuse went to two against Indiana. Virginia Tech makes it a little bit closer here. This one's going to come down to the wire. One of six games tonight in the challenge. And a round of applause for Morcell, who will go off to the bench, likely for the remainder of the game. The ranks continue to thin for NC State, knowing that Manny Bates is out for the year. Greg Gant, the Providence transfer, is still a ways away from making his debut. No Cam Hayes as well.
Alonzo Verge, 20 points, 9 rebounds, 6 assists, 2 steals. He has been the star of the night for Nebraska. Got off to a slow start with turnovers early in this game, but he has responded and given his team a chance to get a win here on the road.
Sebron's got it. He turns the corner and gets bumped. No shot attempt despite the ball going through the rim.
But that's what you want. You want someone attacking the basket, not settling, especially being down only one. Find a way to get to the free throw line. Give yourself an opportunity. If you can't get a shot up, get fouled, get an opportunity at the free throw line to get this lead back. And NC State has had a tremendous advantage at the line throughout this game tonight.
And Sebron has been phenomenal at the stripe, 7 of 8. He's almost made half of the NC State free throws tonight. That's a big miss, though, because the best they can come away with here on a make is just a tie game.
I mean, 7.2 seconds is an eternity for Nebraska to get a quality look on their other end of the floor.
Second free throw, good. Tied at 70. Nebraska with a chance to win it. Alonzo Verge puts it up, and we're tied at 70. Regulation is not enough.
And Verge cannot believe there was no foul called on that possession. He did the right thing, attacking the basket, put the pressure on the officials to get a basket. But right now, Fred Hoiberg not happy about the no call on the last possession.
He's corralled by Matt Abdelmassi, his assistant. Let's see it again.
Get a look as Verge attacks the basket. You'll see, hard to tell from that angle if there's contact from Smith to Verge. This angle will show. There is contact on the hand. However, you can also argue hand is part of the ball. 50-50 call. I can appreciate the no call on that one. Allow the players to decide it with 5 minutes in the overtime.
Meanwhile, if he's watching, Duke's Mark Williams is going, hey, I could have used a no call like that the other night. So 70-70, put 5 more minutes on the clock for overtime. Michigan State a winner, 7-3. It takes 8 to clinch. So more likely than not that the Big Ten will win one more game here. But this has been exciting. Mike Cousins, Corey Alexander, Nebraska trying to make it 5 straight wins. They've been averaging 81 points a game. NC State holding them underneath that. And Verge still chatting with Bill Covington, wondering, when is contact a foul?
But I like the fact that they're having that conversation, and more importantly, that Bill Covington is having that conversation in comparison to walking away saying, we're not going to talk about this. One thing that you have, of course, ACC venue, you have great officials who are very personable and will have those conversations with you. I love the fact that they had that. And again, if you're Verge, you can't allow that play to stop you from going out and being the same guy that you were that allowed your team to be this good here tonight and have a chance to win in overtime.
Both teams with shorter benches than when the night began. Kobe Webster and Lat Mayen ejected during a scuffle, as we can appropriately call it, in front of the NC State bench. Cam Hayes sent packing in that as well. Walker has been hesitant to shoot in the second half, and it's going the other way.
DeWanna now with his 5th block shot, that one going off the back of the head of Walker and getting possession to the Wolfpack.
Walker got off to a really nice start, but has stagnated scoring-wise. He's got 8 on 4 of 6 shooting for the Huskers' big man. It's been very much a two-man game in the second half for NC State on offense between Sebron and Helms. And Morcell was helped off with a left leg injury. Oh, my goodness! DeWanna sends that into the front row. doing his best Manny Bates impersonation tonight on defense.
Yeah, Kevin Keats told us earlier that he felt like DeWanna had been paying attention to Manny Bates, and it's showing right now as DeWanna comes up with a huge block, I believe, what should be his sixth of the evening.
Well, it's his home court. You'd hope they'd lean toward another block for him, right?
Well, in that case, we'll give him seven. The seventh block on the evening for DeWanna. Maintaining the tie basketball game for the Wolfpack.
Manny Bates, shoulder injury, out for the year in the first game of the season. He's led the league the last couple years. This is elite company here for DeWanna, who along with Jalen Gibson, Kevin Keats trying to put together an offensive-defensive hybrid between those two. DeWanna holding his own, the bigger bodied among those two.
But that 1.8 number was the number coming in. That's going to rise significantly when you consider seven block shots on the night so far. And in overtime, DeWanna probably feeling as though he's not done. One thing for certain, Nebraska's going to continue to attack the basket and give him opportunities to come up with block shots.
Crutches for Casey Morsell. Not a great sight for him, as he had a really nice night offensively, scoring 14 points for the second consecutive game after he did that over the weekend against Louisiana Tech. And hope that'll be a fleeting time out of the starting lineup for Morsell.
But you got to also consider no Cam Hayes, no Morsell, the starting backcourt for NC State. You're already talking about no Manny Bates and, of course, Greg Gantt. Unavailable to play yet as he continues to rehab and hopefully get back on the court for the Wolfpack. So Kevin Keats' squad clearly shorthanded coming down the stretch here in overtime, but wanting to try to find a way to pull off a win here on their home court.
There's the third game of the challenge that has gone to overtime. Wake and Northwestern did it in one extra session yesterday. It took Syracuse and Indiana two at the Carrier Dome. 70-70 our score at the end of regulation, 4:08 left in overtime. In for Walker, who gives it back to Verge. Left-handed feed on the baseline. Wiltshire sent it high into the corner. There's just five on the shot clock here. So McGowan's fades away with an air ball into the arms of Helms.
Great job defensively by NC State coming out of the timeout. Kevin Keats imploring his guys to get it done in the half court. And they answered the challenge of their coach, getting the stop. But 0 point score combined for either of these teams in the overtime session so far after we saw such a fast pace earlier.
Back-to-back possessions with ugly three-point looks. Wiltshire, he doesn't get it. Dangerous save there from Sebron underneath the opposing team's basket. Fortunately, his teammates there for him. Almost 2 minutes gone. Nobody scored in overtime. After a Sebron drive and kick, it's passed to the basket with the left. It rolls around and out. Walker firmly secures the board. Verge misses. Helms just lets it go. Zavall, or I should say, this has almost devolved as tanks have started to empty into one-on-one possessions.
Yeah, we've mentioned who's not in the game. Also have to consider Darion Sebron playing with what is a very sore knee. But he has still been aggressive throughout this game. Going to have to find a way to get him attacking the basket. If I'm Kevin Keats, I want the ball in the hands of Sebron. Get him trying to find a way to turn the corner. And if he's unable to score, get to the free throw line where he was so effective in the second half.
Verge to the basket. A three-bounce pass to the edge for McGowan's. Back to Verge. Tomenaga from three. And along the sideline, Smith stepped out of bounds. The Huskers keep it on what should have been an NC State possession.
So, Cuzzo, it's about this time that I have to ask you, do you know in recent history, has there ever been an overtime game where neither team scored and went to second overtime because no one put any points on the board?
I hope not. McGowan's great defense from Sebron.
Dangerous pass.
And McGowan's wanting to pick up 94 feet. Here comes Sebron trying to regain control. He gets double teamed. And then the Wolfpack takes a timeout.
Great timeout by Kevin Keats and his staff, recognizing that play was going nowhere. And with the trap on Sebron, calling the timeout, draw something up to try to maintain possession for his team. That was a turnover waiting to happen. And you could see that early with the first pass off the rebound that was a backwards pass. Sebron had to make a big effort to save from going out of bounds. You see this pass. Sebron has to track down and then give McGowan's credit for putting the pressure on as Sebron gets a little out of control, picks up his dribble, and finds himself in a trap. Kevin Keats right on top of it, making the right call, especially at a time where his team needs direction, drawing up something to try to get them to put points on the board here in this overtime.
Outside of four players, Sebron, Helms, McGowan's, and Verge, is there anybody else who you'd want taking a shot as a head coach right now?
Absolutely not. Well, I shouldn't say that. I want K-State to get a look. If he's got a wide open look, I would love for him to have one if I'm Fred Hoiberg in Nebraska. But right now, I want Sebron attacking the basket. I want Helms ready to shoot, but I want Sebron attacking the rim, getting to the basket or to the free throw line.
Out of bounds. It belongs to Nebraska as these two squads have combined to miss the last 13 field goal tries. No one has scored 4 minutes into overtime.
1 minute.
Verge feeds and the lay-in for Derek Walker.
But you see the pick and roll action gets Duwana out of the painted area and the rotation slow getting over.
They miss 13 straight. They make back-to-back buckets at the rim, tied at 72, less than a minute to go. The first meeting between NC State and Nebraska sure has been good.
And the two guys you want making plays, Sebron and Burge, have been the initiators on the last two offensive possessions.
It's Burge who gets free. And he gets the roll as well. 74-72. Wolfpack. Down two. Sebron through traffic. The foul yields two free throw opportunities. Last time he was at the line, made just one of two.
But there's no one on the floor that can stop Darion Sebron when he makes his mind up that he wants to attack the basket. No one on the floor that can stop him from doing so. And again, I would have loved to have seen this from him earlier in the overtime session. And you look at Sebron's numbers on the night, 24 points coming in, averaging close to 19 a game. Still efficient from the floor, to 12 rebounds, now his fifth double-double out of seven games this season. And a strong candidate to be ACC Player of the Week once again after claiming the first ACC Player of the Week award of the season.
Sebron with a new career high scoring total tonight, ties it at 74. And Miami available for you now on the ESPN.
And a great environment at PNC. What an environment for Fred Hoiberg to bring his team into, for many of his players' first ever true road game. Of course, the Big Ten did not have fans a year ago, so even if they played last year, they still were never in a true road environment. But it has been that for them, and they have answered the call here to the tie. 74-74, 16.4 remaining in the first overtime. Now the Wolfpack trying to come up with a stop and possibly force a second overtime after two big free throws from Darion Sebron.
So benches are shorter because of a second half melee in front of the NC State bench. Lat Mayen, number 11 there, gives the shoulder to Jericho Helms. Mayen was ejected. Kobe Webster was ejected. That was for Nebraska. Cam Hayes, a great playmaker for NC State, ejected as well. And that's why you've seen the ball stay in the hands of just a few players here down the stretch in overtime, where a total of 8 points have been scored.
Well, it should stay in the hands of Darion Sebron, who has scored the last 12 points for NC State. No one else from his team has scored since 5:17 remaining in the second half.
Verge and Nebraska, a chance to win it. He drives, he shoots, it rolls off the rim. And we're going to a second overtime. Five minutes won't do it. A timeout at PNC Arena before overtime number two. Well, the end of regulation and the end of the first overtime. Alonzo Verge had the ball in his hands. Both of his attempts didn't go in.
But this time it was great defense by Darion Sebron, getting back in front, contesting the shot, and keeping Verge away from the basket. And you give Sebron a lot of credit, sliding his feet. We talked about his injury earlier in this game. He's taken on a huge role on both ends of the floor for NC State, as has Verge, who has been spectacular. 22 points and 7 assists for him to go along with 9 rebounds. And he has done it all for Nebraska here in this game. It started off very slowly, had a number of quick turnovers, but settled in and found a great rhythm offensively in this game.
The second Big Ten ACC Challenge game in as many nights to go to a second overtime. Syracuse and Indiana did it last night, scoring over 100 each. Dewana, the easiest bucket in the extra period.
Only 17 seconds to score in this overtime. It took over 4 minutes for either team to put any points on the board in the first overtime. So maybe we'll see a different flow in these 5 minutes.
Breidenbach well off of the three-point try.
And we talked about the first time in this environment. This is the first time Wilhelm Breidenbach has played in front of a true road crowd in his career at Nebraska. And maybe a bit jittery on that last pull-up three.
Helms has the size advantage here. He shakes away Tominaga, and it rims off. Good look, didn't get the finish. Verge threads a tight space there to feed McGowan's on the break, tied at 76.
And McGowan's has been quiet in the latter part of the second half, and of course the first overtime has been the Verge show. But Bryce McGowan's now getting involved back in the scoring column here to start the second overtime.
Haas and Smith providing extra ball handlers for State, going deeper into their bench in the second overtime. Helms took some contact, thought there should have been a foul, didn't get it. Tome Naga with a fadeaway three, 79-76, as he continues to deliver deep into the night.
Big bucket by Casey. And you have to appreciate the attack by Nebraska, taking an early look in transition.
It's passed for three. The freshman doesn't have the answer. Right in back secures Nebraska by three. Fewer than 3 minutes in double overtime. And for as great as Sebron has been defensively in this game, that time he got beat and he picks up the foul.
Nebraska getting out in transition. This is how they were dangerous early in the game. Verge to McGowan's, and then Wilcher finding Tominaga in the corner, knocking down the three. And just like that, Nebraska with a three-point lead, and McGowan's at the free throw line with an opportunity to get it to five.
McGowan's the only freshman in the Big Ten to be tops on his team in scoring and rebounding. Getting a true taste of just how good college basketball can be tonight in Raleigh, North Carolina. How much left in the tank for Sebron Helms? Wolfpack and company. Helms straight away shooting three.
So there have been a number of three-point opportunities that Jericho Helms has had that he's turned down. And of course at 6'7", he is bigger than most of the defenders closing out on him. I like the fact that he did raise up to try to take that three. And of course getting fouled, an opportunity at the free throw line to get this back to a one possession game.
Stark disparity for the Wolfpack and the Huskers at the free throw line. Helms can make it a one possession game again. Verge driving, faking, and gets both defenders in the air. Most importantly, Dewana for the layup.
Verge has been special here tonight.
Oh, speaking of special, has Sebron. Like he went off a trampoline from the right block.
But when Sebron makes his mind up that he's going to the rim, there has been nothing Nebraska can do about it. And they haven't been able to stop it the entire evening.
Walker got his body into Dewana and got the desired result with a foul.
Well, Burge and Sebron have both put on a show here, and the answer to the nice drive by Alonzo Burge, Darion Sebron finishes with the highlight. But Nebraska now an opportunity to make this a two-possession game once again at the free throw line. We talked about the discrepancy earlier. Both these teams come into the game averaging 24.3 and 24.5 free throws per game, respectively. Nebraska hasn't had as many opportunities, but they're taking advantage of them here in overtime.
Walker, the third-year Husker, former Tennessee Volunteer, bags both free throws. Huskers by five. Double overtime. We were tied at 70 at the end of regulation.
That's another look, in my opinion. Helms needs to just take that shot in comparison to getting the basketball in others' hands. Allow your senior to step up and make a big play.
Sebron has the opportunity. Loose ball. He stands up, gets his miss. And it's two free throws coming for Sebron, who seemingly has a battery with no expiration date.
You know, if this guy is not one of your favorite players, then you are not truly appreciating basketball. Darion Sebron misses the shot on the floor, still finds a way to come up with the loose ball and stay in attack mode and find a way to send himself to the free throw line. And, of course, he's from the great state of Virginia, so you already know he's one of my favorites.
The Norfolk product, having a career night, has played tonight 46 minutes. We're on the verge of 48 minutes in this game. And he scored 22 points since halftime.
And the only time he sat down is when he had a collision, forcing him out of the game with a sore knee, but came back in and has been just as good with the sore knee as he was earlier in the game, continuing to provide energy for his team.
Lurage sends it back. Wiltshire launches for three. Who else but Sebron with the rebound? Puts the pedal to the floor, gives it up ahead. Lay-in good for pass. 85-84, one-point game. McGowan's wants to turn the corner against Iwana, who sends it into the stands.
Darion Sebron coming up with the rebound, pushing it in transition this time, giving it up. Smith is able to finish it off. And then Iwana with his eighth block shot in emphatic fashion.
Timeout. We're coming right back. Well, with 25 seconds to go, you get the sense that if there's going to be a game-winning shot, it's going to be one of these number ones putting it up.
And both these guys have been number one all night long. Spectacular for their respective teams. And now the 16th rebound for Sebron.
State can win it here on this possession. Kevin Keats saw nothing fruitful developing there with the ball in Smith's hands. He's a scorer, but they want to have an opportunity to draw up something to walk away with a win here in double overtime.
Absolutely, and they want the basketball in the hands of number one. We just talked about Darion Sebron and everything that he's been able to do in this game. And he plays the right way. So in playing the right way, he gets that rebound, he pushes it, he gives the basketball up. I would have loved to have seen him continue to stay in attack mode, get to the rim. There's no one that is going to stop him when he has a full head of steam. If he could do it again, he probably would have kept that basketball and tried to attack the rim to finish or get to the free throw line and give his team a chance for a lead.
This has, at certain points, seemed like it was going to be one team's night or the other. In the first half, NC State led by as many as nine. In the second half, Nebraska had a 14-point lead. And as recently as a minute and 20 seconds to go, it was 85-80 in favor of the Cornhuskers. Now, for the first time at the end of a period, NC State will have a chance to win. Nebraska had opportunities at the end of regulation and the first overtime for Alonzo Verge. It's the Wolfpack's turn. Verge on the verge, and yes, it's Sebron. 86-85, 4.6 to go, another timeout. And Nebraska will have a chance to do it again, but the Wolfpack sitting good up by one.
Interesting that Fred Hoiberg elected to just allow Darion Sebron to catch the basketball on the inbounds play. Again, you know who NC State is going to. You know who the best player on the floor is. Interesting that they did not try to take advantage of denying him the basketball, making someone else have to make a play in comparison to allowing the guy who has made play after play all night long make another play to beat you.
26 second half and overtime points for Sebron, who set a career high in the third game of the year with 24. He's topped that. This is nothing new for Verge. In about a quarter of the games he's played in his career, he's dropped 20 or more, but they've really been needed tonight by the Huskers.
But in those games when he's gotten 20, has he also gotten 10 rebounds and 7 assists to go along with it? He's done it all for Nebraska, only to be outdone by the performance of Darion Sebron in this game thus far. But Verge still with one chance remaining with 4.6 to come out in the, as the winner for his team and in that matchup here tonight.
There is no room for error. There are no timeouts remaining. And there's a long flight across the country waiting for the Huskers. Whether it's a happy one, they'll be the ones to decide. The ball is in. Here come the Huskers. And a foul as they come up the floor. 2.5 to go as McGowan's had it in his hands. An 87% free throw shooter.
And that is a bad foul. With 4 seconds remaining, the last thing you want to do is allow Nebraska to score without having to work on the offensive end.
First free throw is good. We're tied at 86. He gets the front end of the 1-1 and now can put his team in the lead. How is anybody going to go to sleep after this game is over?
Well, I can't speak for anybody else, but I know I'm going to go eat dinner. And I'm going to sleep good because we had an opportunity to see a great basketball game and guys step up making huge plays at the end. And you see great design, but it's clearly a foul. As you get over it, you can't make contact and impede progress 70 feet away from the basket. And right now, if you're Kevin Keats, you're having to tell your team what to do on a miss and on a make, depending upon what happens with this McGowan's free throw.
Biggest moment of McGowan's young career. The freshman misses it. A chance for the Wolfpack. A heave at the buzzer is off the rim. Double overtime. 86-86. Re-racket.
Great timeout by Kevin Keats to ice McGowan's, give him time to think about the free throw in the huddle, and you see the reaction from McGowan's, who's a very good free throw shooter, shocked that he missed that one with an opportunity to win the game for his team. But I would have hate to have seen this great game end at the free throw line.
It has been a roller coaster ride of epic proportions for the Wolfpack and the Cornhuskers. Tied at 70 at the end of regulation. A first overtime where it took more than 4 minutes to get points on the board. A second overtime where a free throw could have decided it, as well as a shot from about 75 feet. And also, had Nebraska emerged victorious at the end of that second overtime, would have clinched the eighth win and the Big Ten ACC challenge for the Big Ten.
Amazing we've played this long already. I'm confused. I'm thinking that it's going into the third overtime, although our graphic says in three overtime. But I think we're going into our third overtime, and at this point, which means we've already played 50 minutes. And NC State doesn't have anyone in significant foul trouble. Three players still available for Nebraska with four fouls, and one Mayan ejected earlier with four, but really still no foul trouble for the Wolfpack.
In this game, a total of four players ejected in the second half. Three for Nebraska, one for NC State. Casey Morsell injured, left leg injury. He's not going to return. Darion Sebron left the game with an injury. He came back. And this, in the history of the Big Ten ACC Challenge, is the first game that has gone three overtimes. Burns takes the screen. The feed for Walker got away. Beautiful job by Pass to go headlong and save it. And Helms comes the length of the floor and gets called for an offensive foul.
And now that's going to be the fourth on Helms. So I spoke too soon, as Helms now enters the foul trouble area for NC State. And that's a play where Jericho Helms, you have to recognize the defender is setting up many seconds before you get there to take that charge, pull up and shoot the quick jumper.
McGowan's looked stunned when he missed that free throw at the end of the second overtime, because when you've been good at basketball for as long as he has, a miss is more surprising than a make, and he had an easy path to the left side of the basket.
Is that what you think it was? I think McGowan's wanted to put more points on the board, so he figured we'll play another 5 minutes and let me continue to add to this total as I'm putting up numbers continuously throughout this game.
Yeah, you're transposing the Corey Alexander School of Offensive Thought onto a freshman.
I mean, again, you know, he is putting up more and more numbers, added two more points to his total, although he misses his second consecutive free throw.
Helms had a look from three, an even better one from two, and it's been that kind of night. Good looks that have just rolled out.
I still believe that Helms, with his size, has the ability to shoot over top of retreating defenders and get off a good look from three.
Type of contact there that could have been a foul. The whistles remain silent. The shot clock at 10. Verge off the Walker screen. This is Wiltshire. He cans it. And Nebraska's lead is now 4, 2 minutes into the third overtime.
And that's Wiltshire's first bucket of the game. Now 1 for 8 from the field, as he's played significantly hard and defended very well in this game, but was 0-for-7 from 3, steps inside the line and knocks down his first bucket of the game.
Really a nearly identical look to what Helms had the last time down the floor, but clearly the left hand impeding the path of Sebron on his trip to the basket.
And Wiltshire will be disqualified with his fifth foul after that foul, putting points on the board for the first time tonight, and then out of the game. He's been the primary defender on Darion Sebron throughout this game, so it'll be interesting to see which direction Fred Hoiberg goes now to try to slow Sebron down.
So that's no Webster, no Mann ejected, no Wiltshire disqualified. As the ranks continue to thin in the first triple overtime game in the Big Ten ACC Challenge. It took two overtimes last night. Syracuse and Indiana both scored over 100. This game is going to go three full overtimes. Nobody might get to 100.
But one guy could score half the points for that team. Darion Sebron now with 34 points. And if NC State's going to win this game, he's going to continue to put points on the board for the remainder of this overtime.
Verge leading the Huskers with 24 to the corner for Breidenbach, whose shot has not been there tonight.
And he's a capable three-point shooter, but again, it's different playing against this level of competition as Sebron picks up the offensive foul. And now that's going to be four on Darion Sebron. So we talked about very little foul trouble for NC State coming into this third overtime. Now Sebron, as well as Jericho Helms, both with four. And have to be extremely careful for the remaining 2:25.
McGowan's, who has the ball, also four fouls. Walker drops it off. Breidenbach, and one!
And that's an area, if you're Jericho Helms, you have to recognize where you are on the floor. If he jumps, all he has to do is leave the floor, keep his arms straight up, and he won't get called for that foul because of verticality. But because he stays on the ground in the restricted area, it is an automatic foul and will disqualify Jericho Helms from this game. One of NC State's best players will not continue the remaining 2:14 of the third overtime.
A third regular who is done for the night for the Wolfpack.
And you see Helms as he comes over, you have to jump. You have to be able to go vertical, stay straight up in the air, not to pick up their foul. If there's any contact within the restricted arc, it is going to be an automatic foul, and this chance, this opportunity for three for Breidenbach.
So Hayes ejected, Helms disqualified, Morsell injured, and Breidenbach missed the free throw. The lead remains four. In regulation, the Huskers had a lead as large as 14. NC State in the first half had a lead that ballooned to nine.
And the Huskers now changing the defense, going to the 2-3 zone with Helms on the bench. You've got to identify Smith as the shooter. But
second chance opportunity didn't drop for Smith. And Ted Thomas Valentine Allen has called a foul.
Thomas Allen, the Nebraska transfer, making his debut in the game with 2:15 remaining. And getting involved in the mix, coming up with the offensive rebound as Breidenbach over the back picks up the foul, which will be his fifth, and disqualify him from Nebraska's lineup.
It's gotten to the point where it's almost like Santa listing off the reindeer. Now Wiltshire, now Webster, now Mahan, now Breidenbach. All are done for the night for Nebraska.
I thought that was the nice and naughty list.
Well, now Dasher, Dancer, Prancer, Vixen, you know, getting them all ready to go.
Okay.
Thomas Allen, the redshirt senior from Raleigh, who started his career at Nebraska in the 17, 18, and 18, 19 seasons, where he played for Tim Miles. He's now the head coach at San Jose State. And they're going to the monitor here to have a look at that foul there with Breidenbach and Allen getting mixed up under the basket. And usually when this is the case, it's to see if there's a potential for a flagrant foul.
No, I believe at this point they're probably trying to make sure they have the right shooter getting in the mix with Allen getting in there. And, of course, Smith was involved in the mix. They want to make sure that it's Allen going to the free throw line in comparison to Smith.
Ted Valentine talking to Tony Henderson, one of the other officials, as they get everything sorted out, and they do, with Allen waiting patiently at the free throw line. He's got the first one on just his third free throw attempt of the year. He came in 0 for 2.
And Allen, who was injured in the preseason, now finding himself on the verge of being out of the rotation for NC State at this point, fighting back through injury, did not play in their last game versus Louisiana Tech, although played the five previous games. As Wiltshire getting involved, can't be in the game anymore, but doing a great job wiping the floor over there along with the coaching staff, managers, everyone involved from Nebraska. Breidenbach coming over looking as though he spilled some of his Gatorade bottle. Or
as we all know in basketball, there's no crying, certainly not over spilled Gatorade. In our third overtime since the end of regulation, it's Nebraska 22, NC State 20. The Wolfpack have something to say about how that's gone. On the steal, Smith back rims it. Duwana fighting for the rebound, dives in front of the bench, and he gets a timeout. The extra effort makes a difference from the big man.
Great job by Thomas Allen coming over, getting the steal, and then finding Smith in transition. Nebraska, who has struggled to take care of their defensive boards all year, once again struggled to corral the basketball. Duwana gets on the floor, maintaining possession for NC State and giving them an opportunity to tie this game or possibly take a lead here in the third overtime.
1:25 left and a timeout at PNC Arena in Raleigh. The sixth inning. Oh, wait, it's the third overtime, actually, with this line score. It's been insane today. Mike Cousins, Corey Alexander, 92-90, Nebraska and NC State. It's the first time these two teams have ever played, and the first triple overtime game in the Big Ten ACC Challenge. A baseline feed by Sebron, ill-advised, as it's taken away by Nebraska.
And right now, for NC State, you have numbers. Try to find a good look in transition. That's always going to be successful.
And that's out of bounds off of Sebron. Oh, quite unlucky carom there. As if he corralled it, perhaps an easy lay-in. And instead, in his haste, it goes off his hand.
But the officials are going to review this and make sure they've gotten it right. And Sebron looks as though he was last to touch that. Walker does a good job getting over, getting his hand on the basketball. But as he throws it back in, you see Sebron get a hand on it. And Walker stays out of the way. That basketball will go back to Nebraska. Great job by Walker getting back defensively and coming up with a huge defensive stop with Darion Sebron coming at you with a full head of steam.
Corey, one thing, though, here is that if Walker was standing out of bounds when he touched the ball, this is going to be NC State ball.
Oh, that is a good point, but the whistle wasn't blown at that point. And so the thing is, I'm not sure if the officials can go back and cause the interruption at that point if that wasn't the call on the floor. So when you think about it, the basketball was still in play. You can see the official under the baseline not actually blow the whistle and make a call until the ball goes out on Sebron. I'm not sure if they can go back and reverse that, even though it does look as though Walker was on the line when he touched it. That was not called on the floor.
Well, one of the updates to the rule book they made this year was an out-of-bounds play in the last 2 minutes, which certainly we are here in the third overtime and a minute to go. The phrase, which was when deflected by two players, removed from the rule book this year, and so the officials can review out-of-bounds plays as long as an out-of-bounds call is made on the floor. And so it's a matter of kind of like a touchdown catch in football. Was the foot in? Did you have the ball? All that along the baseline between Walker and Sebron.
Well, the good thing is we'll find out together because it does look as though Walker is on the line. Great play, but you see, I'm not sure if Walker actually was on the line. It would be difficult to dispute because you see his right foot is still in the air and has not touched down behind him. His left foot is still in bounds when he has his hand on the basketball. I'm not sure if there's enough evidence on that play to confirm that he was actually out of bounds to go back and change it at that point.
And by the letter of the law, what the officials need here is indisputable video evidence to overturn the call on the floor, which is that the ball belongs to Nebraska. So
you see, when he touches the basketball, the left foot is still in bounds. The right foot is still in the air. If we can see that one more time, our guys have been great to us in the truck tonight as the officials deliberate. But that right foot was still in the air as it gets close. The left foot is still in bounds. Right foot in the air as he touches the basketball. His hand is now off the ball. He wasn't out of bounds, so they can't necessarily call that. There's definitely not evidence from that. So this basketball will go back to Nebraska. Darion Sebron takes it out last. And after all that, I was wrong. It stays with NC State.
Well, Corey, from what we saw, it certainly appeared as though your analysis was correct, that Walker was not yet out of bounds. Nevertheless, the officials say otherwise, and that's a break for the Wolfpack. 22 seconds on the shot clock for Sebron and company. He's got space. He takes the three and misses.
And that's the first time we have seen Darion Sebron settle. Of course, fatigue has to be a factor at this point of the game. But that's the first settle we've seen from him. He's been awesome getting downhill, getting to the basket, getting to the free throw line. But he chose to settle on that possession.
McGowan's can make it a two-possession game. He's got Tomei Naga, who launches a three. Missed it long. 20 seconds to decide the game. Maybe. Here we are, third overtime. A stumbling drive to the basket. That misses. The follow is good. Dewana ties it at 92. Quickly down the floor. Layup try off the rim. The Wolfpack with a chance to win it. Triple overtime for the win. No good. We're staying up all night in Raleigh.
The last 25 seconds of action was a whirlwind. Nebraska unable to knock down the three, and then you see NC State getting out in transition. A great attack by Smith, unable to finish, but Dewana there to finish it up. And then Bryce McGowan gets behind the defense. Give Dewana credit for getting back, contesting the shot. And once again, it's an opportunity for NC State to win it at the buzzer. Unable to knock down the three. His pass is unable to finish the shot. And we will have even more bonus basketball, which will be a full half, 20 minutes of extra basketball here at PNC Arena in Raleigh tonight to decide the winner between NC State and Nebraska here in the Big Ten ACC Challenge.
You are witnessing history tonight. In the history of ACC basketball, this is only the fifth quadruple overtime game. There has never been a five overtime game.
I'm going to go out on a limb and let's hope there never is a five overtime game. Hey, this has been fun.
You got somewhere to be?
Yes. Yes, I do. I have to eat. But at this point, And you know, when you think about this game, it's difficult to watch either one of these teams have to leave. And now you look at Alonzo Verge, who has done everything possible. But at this point, having to be stretched out, I'm sure cramps could become an issue. I mean, you're talking about playing 20 extra minutes of basketball in a 60-minute game. That's an NFL game, cuzzo.
And it's with shortened benches already. These two teams came in with, respectively, one of their best players injured for quite some time. Trey McGowan's for Nebraska, Manny Bates for NC State. Jericho Helms has fouled out. Cam Hayes has been ejected. Here's a three, much needed, from Terquavion Smith. NC State by three. Wiltshire, Webster, Mayen, Breidenbach all have either tonight been ejected or fouled out. And Casey Morsell hurt for NC State. Tomei Naga with a rare drive, collects his own miss. The much higher difficulty shot, also no good.
And right now, Nebraska gonna drop back into the 2-3 zone. And if you're Terquavion Smith right now, you're looking for every opportunity you can get. Jericho Helms on the bench, and Smith will stay aggressive, looking for his opportunities from beyond the arc.
Top of the key, an airballed three from Pass. He had the chance to win it from there at the end of last overtime. And Terquavion Smith, a three-time North Carolina state champion and the Gatorade Player of the Year, vaults the Wolfpack up by a bucket. No lead has been safe tonight in this building. It's a one-point game once again.
And normally, if you're NC State at this point in the game, you would want Darion Sebron to be your guy on the interior of that zone. But with Cam Hayes ejected, Sebron had to take over at the point guard position. And so he is actually running the offense for NC State at this point. And you take away their best guy to have in the middle of the zone when you think about Jericho Helms on the sideline after fouling out with his five fouls. So the two best players to have on the interior of that zone for NC State, unable to be able to do so. But always a good thing to get Sebron at the free throw line.
Just one, the lead is two for the Wolfpack. 2 minutes into the fourth overtime. Webster, a three. Darion Sebron, 35 points tonight on 10 of 21 shooting to go along with a heroic 18 rebounds. Second straight airball shot. It's cleaned up by Thomas Allen, the former Husker.
And offensive rebounding is coming back to bite the Cornhuskers, not taking care of the glass.
Disbelief from most in the building that a foul was called there.
Pursuing the basketball, Thomas Allen stepping up, making plays for his team. Did not enter the game until the third overtime against his former program in Nebraska, but still stepping up and making plays for his team to try to get a win in this game. Now, Cuzzo, I've got a question for you. As Kobe Webster knocked down a shot earlier, it took me back. I thought Kobe Webster was one of the guys who was ejected.
That is what was relayed to us from the scorer's table. Evidently not the case.
So, or did you get a pass from being ejected from the first couple of overtimes, but you get to come back once the game gets to 3 and 4? Was that the case?
It's a rule change year. I missed that this year, though. We'll have to check with our friend J.D. Collins.
Well, I can tell you Kobe Webster's name was on our list of players that were ejected in this game.
Sebron lost it around his shoelaces. Webster had it. He lost it. And a shot clock violation. No clear possession had been gained. And so it goes back to Nebraska, down by 3. It's Walker. Too much off the rim. Couple of good opportunities the last two trips down the floor by Nebraska.
And you can look at the floor and see that at this point these guys are running on fumes. Right now you're asking young men to do a lot. Especially playing, you talking about Darion Sebron, who has played well over 50 minutes in this game.
Dewana sends it out, and perhaps the best thing the Wolfpack can do here with a three-point lead is take as much time out of those 20 seconds as they can get.
And if I'm Sebron, I want to attack the basket once again. They haven't stopped him all night. Whenever he's wanted to go, he can get there.
He hangs and scores. 37 for Sebron as the Wolfpack hit 100.
And Cuzzo, you said that no one was going to get to 100 in this game. Take it back.
I was not so bold, Corey, as to predict 4 overtimes tonight. Darion Sebron with 37 ties the Big Ten ACC Challenge scoring record. This game's not done yet. History tonight in Raleigh, North Carolina. Fourth overtime. NC State leads Nebraska by 5. Huskers have the ball out of the timeout. Verge with the drive. 3 defenders crash down. Now McGowan's trapped in the corner. Contact, no whistle. He lays it in for 2.
Nice take by Bryce McGowan's. And Nebraska will now play the foul game. However, Darion Sebron, who has gotten more than enough practice at the free throw line tonight, as we see McGowan's with very little legs at this point of the game, still able to finish. But Darion Sebron, 18 free throw attempts in this game, and no one stepping up to foul Sebron, so it has to be Alonzo Verge, who flirted with a triple-double in this game, now fouls out with 25 points, 10 rebounds, and 8 assists. And that's a big loss for Nebraska here, as neither of these teams have been able to separate from each other in these 4 overtimes, and we can't say that this is over yet.
In the first overtime, each team scored 4 points. In the second, they tripled that. They each scored 12, matched with 6 apiece in the third. And here in the fourth, the Wolfpack have been 4 points better as Darion Sebron has now leapfrogged both Wake Forest, Justin Gray, and Will Solomon of Clemson, who previously were tied with 37 points for the challenge scoring record. 39 on the night. A 5-point lead under 30 seconds to go, and all the pressure's on Nebraska. The freshman McGowan's desperation try. That 3 doesn't fall. Offensive board tipped out of bounds. 13.7 to operate. It's Keon Edwards back onto the floor with the disqualification of Verge with the 5 fouls.
And the officials will go over and review to make sure. Actually, they're not going to. Teddy Valentine certain that it went off of Allen under the basket. They're not even going to look at this one.
McGowan's, he's got to get it up. His shot is short. Pass has it, and the Wolfpack feeling victory in their sights. Nobody has scored as many as Sebron tonight. 39 for the Wolfpack since TJ Warren all the way back in March of 2014 when he had 41.
2 seconds remaining. Not a lot of time, but from what we've seen tonight, I don't want to declare this over yet.
That makes you wise.
However, Darion Sebron has put on a show at PNC tonight, attacking the basket time after time, laying his body on the line for his team, finishing at the rim, getting to the free throw line, finding himself on many highlights as he has continued to stay aggressive and fight through playing 55 plus minutes. And 39 points. At this point, I'm hoping he gets the basketball and gets fouled. An opportunity to be able to walk away with a 40-point night here in this game. But that won't come to pass because he's throwing the basketball in.
The clock down to 1.1. On the inbounds. In a night where we talked about the legacy of Coach Valvano, we heard from Emeka Emezi earlier talking about how in the game against North Carolina last week, he was in search of motivation. He found it, saying never give up. And that has certainly had to be a mantra tonight for these teams, where nobody can claim on either side that being shorthanded was an issue, because it has impacted both sides to a great extent. And what a fitting coda to this game for the only player on the floor to have suited up for both squads to be shooting free throws. Thomas Allen. History made tonight. 104-100. NC State defeats Nebraska. There will be regrets, there will be injuries, and there will be a night full of memories that many will never forget.
And there will be a day off tomorrow for both teams after this effort. Coaches, give your guys a day off. They both deserve it.
Well, we haven't been able to say much with certainty tonight, but now we can absolutely say that the Big Ten ACC Challenge of 2021 has a tally of 7-4, and for the ACC, three of those wins have gone to overtime. Big Ten needs just one more to clinch it. And we thank you for being patient, our colleagues as well for their patience, as we've hogged the airways. We'll get you to Miami, Penn State with Mike Corey and Chris Spatola. For Corey, our crew, I'm Mike saying good night.